offense. Here, I'll watch. Streaming is starting.
Troubleshooting is starting.
Mm-hmm.
How many seconds until someone says they're echoing? Something's happening.
It is happening. This.
Yeah, you forgot an apostrophe there.
Mm-hmm.
But shadowing, it's all right. Perfect audio. Yeah, we're together in the same room today. I look much larger than Geoff because I'm sitting closer.
Someone's saying no sound. Is that for reals or is that for jokes?
Shadowing says perfect audio. I'm going to trust that he's not.
Good audio.
Totally
awesome.
All right, sweet.
Yeah, it's good.
Awesome.
Yeah, I got some new gear this stream. In fact, Jarett upgraded his camera.
I didn't.
So you might notice we are actually in full 1080p. It's a lot of P's.
That's what I wanted to test out.
Yeah, so just make sure it's all working. We've got the actual full 1080p.
Sweet. Yeah, look at that. You've got the option of seeing us in low, medium, high, or source 1080p, 30 frames per second.
Mm-hmm. All
right. Sweet. My previous camera, although it advertised 1080p when I bought it, which was a few years ago, so it's a bit older, only actually did 1080p in 15 frames per second. So I thought that that was a little bit of false advertising because that frame rate isn't good enough to actually use that resolution. So it really was a 1080p still camera and a 720p webcam. And they've never seen my chest hair so clearly. Oh, God, I should shave lower, huh? I can't remember. I think I was doing, it was either the Geminis or like an awards thing I was doing, and I went and got like a new suit or something. And the gay man who helped me pick out my suit and gave me really good advice on everything suit related, because I'm pretty newbie when it comes to suits.
You were like,
chest hair. My chest hair. So he strongly recommended to me, like looked me in the eye and strongly recommended that I should shave my chest hair below what's visible for this event. And it's not always bad, but for an event of this caliber, I should not have chest hair showing. That's what he recommends me.
Really? Because I guess it's in my culture. I would have liked...
Which is bears?
Yeah, bear culture.
Yeah.
But like just my understanding of fashion and culture, which is like super noob and super not actual fashion or like fashion culture, I would like assume that would mean, would be an indication of bisexuality or homosexuality. If a man is like shaving his chest hair and like, wearing a low cut, whatever. Like
not just metrosexuality.
Metro as well, I guess. Yeah. But so, but of course, that's my like outdated, like,
yeah,
'90s ideas about fashion. And,
yeah.
I thought I would never be embarrassed to show chest hair, at least the amount that I have.
You won't be in your lifetime, but your grandchildren might be embarrassed for you.
Yeah, well, for sure, for sure. I imagine someday there'll be like that old man that doesn't just shave his chest. He's an embarrassment.
Yeah, like, but body hair is on the way out for sure. I think all body hair. We're just sort of becoming more and more hairless as time goes on, I think, right?
Mm-hmm.
Females particularly, but start with the armpits and it's like the full leg. Now it's like the entire body. And men more and more, it's going to become that too. Certain types of hair are just not attractive.
Yeah.
You've got to get rid of them. And I imagine another 100 years, there'll just be a bunch of hairless people walking around, except the hair on the top of their head or whatever. And it's more services to sell you, more products to sell you. It's unnecessary maintenance.
Yes. If one company had the monopoly on hair removal, I imagine there would be a lot of money being marketed towards changing culture. Like just like De Beers, I don't know if many of the viewers know this, but the idea of an engagement ring was created in the 1930s and 40s by product placement in films. And De Beers has a monopoly on diamonds for many reasons. Economic reasons is a natural monopoly. And so, yeah, it was the idea of an engagement ring. You have to buy two rings, a wedding ring and an engagement ring, was invented and marketed, and now is a huge part of our culture. So, you know, I imagine if there was a monopoly on hair removal, we would have zero hair on our bodies, and that would be the norm, and it would be unfashionable and whatever else to have some body hair. But hey, what do you think? We should get Stacy to Facebook this update.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm gonna text Stacy, even though she's in the other
room. Trying to stay so still. How are you guys doing tonight, chat? Talk to us. I want to hear from you. How are your lives? Your families?
Mm-hmm.
You good? Fantastic. That's good. Hey, Myra.
Oh, look what someone brings up here. See, Heroes of the Storm.
Doing great, chilling, quiet day, chilling, everybody's good. The guy's family's dead. Mm. I guess I can. Great for everybody. My life is balls deep in amazement. Did you see Heroes of the Storm?
Right. We were just talking about that, in fact.
Just very briefly.
Yeah, and I... it's funny how the whole fountain thing and then your nexus, and you know, without knowing anything about the game, I know what's what, right? Like MOBA has, they're developing.
There's a language.
There's right? a language yeah. to it, right? And it's like, okay, and it's in corners, and it's not, it's on yeah. the diamond, not the square. And yeah, it's a real standard new game coming out that seems to be just like destroying RTS. But yep. yeah, I've like, from what I hear, I don't know much about it. I was going to ask Jarett more so, and more so the chat, to answer this question, but is it like LOL simplified and Dota simplified? Is it, I hear it's like the baby yeah. version of all that, and they're going for that niche, that yeah. market.
Yeah. Which might be the right thing to do mm-hmm. because, you know, that's how MOBA started. It was the simplified RTS. It was the simplified Warcraft 3. It's like, hey, don't worry about all the different heroes and building a base and doing all this stuff. We'll just give you one guy. Give him like a handful of spells, just focus on that one guy, work with other people, and there's enough happening that you're always occupied. So it was like an ultra newbie RTS, and they still, like, you see reviews of MOBAs and stuff, like they always refer to the RTS roots, and really they're like almost nothing alike other than it came from an engine, RTS engine. But anyway, so I think Blizzard's taking that the next step because it's been proven that you know, simplifying and casualifying the game brings in a bigger audience, which makes the esport bigger.
Mm-hmm.
But from what I've heard, again, I didn't do a ton of reading, but I saw some interviews with pro players who have like played it, but it seems to be like too newified. Like it seems like maybe it's gonna, I mean, I'll reserve judgment until I play it, but I mean, they're talking about like there's no individual levels or something. There's like team levels. There's no item shop. Like you can't customize in game or strategy. Like you just level up, but all of your team experience is pooled, I heard.
Really?
Yeah. So when you like, and there's no last hitting.
So
like
so
you just
so
you just kill minions and you just you guys the whole team goes up in experience. Like there's no.
So there's no individual award for like your Andean success.
Yes. Yes. Exactly. So you can't carry a whole team of suckasses. Like if you're just killing it, you aren't gonna max out and do crazy.
That's great for the people that suck at the game getting
yeah,
carried
exactly.
by sharing XP.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. It'll be that much easier to blame your team. You know, you're not gonna see that you're one. That you're the guy holding everybody back. You're like, look, we're all
mm-hmm.
this level.
Mm-hmm. Someone wants to. Well, maybe I should change the subject right now. But anyway, what do you guys think about what is it? HOTS? What do you mean call it?
Well, that's what's really funny to me too. That it has to be HOTS. But the thing is, I guess by the time it's released, Legacy of the Void will be out. You know, because HOTS is the current abbreviation for StarCraft 2. It's like StarCraft 2, Heart of the Swarm. And they put in a new game, Heroes of the Storm. It's like, really? Like, really? There's
good.
Like,
yeah.
You couldn't think of a name that wasn't HOTS?
And even the name, Heroes of the Storm, is so generic.
It's so generic, yeah.
It's like,
yeah.
It's like champions of
yeah.
the, like, Hurricane, you know, like it's the same thing. Like it's
dungeon heroes.
Yeah.
Hero
of the
fighters.
Of the what? You gotta they gotta be up to something.
Yeah.
I call it heroes instead of hots. I see.
It also, like, graphically, I thought it was really beautiful, but it looked a bit clunky, too. Like, the way everything was split, it looked very slow. It looked like everything was happening in almost, like, slow motion. And, and when I saw the units moving, it just... Nah. Anyways, hopefully I get beta. That would be very nice.
Yeah, did you sign up?
I did. I signed up immediately.
I haven't signed up, so...
Yeah. No, I'm totally going to give that shit a crazy try.
But you know they released their roster of characters, and it's a weird thing. It's like... You know, it's like reminds you of like Who Framed Roger Rabbit when they had like all that's like Disney characters and Warner Brothers characters. It's like, oh, there's Mickey Mouse and Donald Duck and what's his name? Bugs Bunny, you know, in the same movie, right? And it's like, oh, they got StarCraft characters, they have Warcraft characters, they have Diablo characters. And I didn't play Diablo, I played StarCraft and Warcraft. I don't recognize a single name of any of these characters. Like, I don't recognize any of them. Is there any value to bringing in Blizzard IP characters to this game? Are people going to be excited? Oh, I can't wait to see what this character's ability is that is so developed and am I into the lore of World of Warcraft?
I play WoW a lot. Like, I had level 6, couple level 60s, but I put in a lot of time. I played Warcraft 3, Warcraft 2, Warcraft 1. I played the StarCraft, StarCraft Brood War, StarCraft 2. It's like, I don't know who half those characters are. Don't give a fuck at all.
Yeah.
Didn't play for that. Never cared about the lore. So already it's Blizzard fans are appealing to. And how many of those actually care enough about the lore to be excited to play some totally obscure guy?
Yeah. Well, also Smash Brothers is another good example.
Of course, I recognize Arthas, but there's 18 of them. And if we can go through them right now, I can point out the ones that I have no fucking clue.
Smash Brothers has all the Nintendo IP characters, right? So that was kind of cool how it's like, oh, this person, that person's got these moves, and you know a little bit about this guy and Link, you know, you always want to play, whatever. But so it seems like there's more value there, but like Blizzard characters, it's like they haven't developed them very much, and there's no heroes that you've played before in their character rosters, so. But of course,
Warcraft 3 had a pretty deep story, remember? I don't know if you remember Arthas and all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And that was, the cinematics and story, but just that World of Warcraft, it never felt like that to me. Maybe it's the way that I approach MMOs, the type of MMO player that I am. But maybe other people really did pay attention to cinematics. But to me, it's like MMOs aren't about story. They're not single player games. You're not like a story vehicle. They're open world, create your own story through exploration kind of.
And with your guild drama and, that's the story.
Yeah.
So. But I remember, I think Myron even was into some of the lore, and I would groan whenever there was lore in like dungeons. It's like, I will talk to blah, blah, blah. I was just like, whatever, what do?
Can you skip other people's lore? What game is that? I remember I had some friends that I played with, Derek and John, and they would be furious at me.
If you skipped lore.
Yeah, and when I played by myself, I would just skip it instantly. Maybe it was Diablo 3. Yeah, I think it was Diablo 3, where if you're playing as a group, you can just, like, one player skips the lore and it just skips it. And I got reamed out one night just because a couple times I skipped. I'm like, dude, please don't do that anymore. I'm like, okay. And as soon as the next lore starts, it's like, skip. And I wasn't trying to be a dick. It's that
you were
like,
just natural.
It's like instant. It's like, oh, it's some lore shit.
Yeah, that would be really annoying if you're into lore.
Yeah, oh, it would be terrible.
That would be like, let's fast forward this boring dialogue scene. In this Coen Brothers movie to get to the action scene.
I'm an unsophisticated.
I guess bad at Diablo
player.
But,
dude, Blizzard lore is amazing. Come on, did you fucking play Diablo 3, dude? I unless it was supposed to be a comedy, man, because I laughed more at that than I have laughed at almost anything I've played or watched in a long time. And some of the dialogue, I was just. In complete disbelief that they sat in a room and recorded that and no one said out loud, like, dude, that's terrible. Like, that's the most on-the-nose dialogue it could possibly be written.
Well, to be honest, I have never given Blizzard lore a chance. I've always just, the snippets I've seen, none of it has sucked me in, so I just always skipped it. And it's a different tone, I think. Like lore in video games is always so cheesy and on-the-nose, and that's the style, I guess, but... No one has done I guess Fallout 3's story is good. It's gritty. It's real. They have some characterization.
There's some amazing Half-Life 2. Oh, Jesus, man.
Yeah.
Well, maybe not so much the story, but I guess, you know, gaming for me is more about the universe that they created, the environment they created, and the feeling I had. I'm not sure I've ever been as scared running through the world as I was in Half-Life 2, far more so than like a Resident Evil or anything like that. That's supposed to be like scary, where you're waiting for the next thing to jump out, ha ha ha, in the dark and spooky, zombie infested. But Half-Life 2 is scary because you're running around and you're like, this could be our world. Like it was one, it was that close to home, you know, horrifying reality. And it was put together so well. And the dialogue in Half-Life 2 is amazing. Like the speeches given by whatever the great leader was, this character, it's been so many years. I would just stop in the terminals and just listen. And I don't know who wrote that stuff, but really, really awesome.
Fallout 3 is a glitch fest with rumble barriers everywhere. Did you play it on a non-PC?
I don't know. What's a rumble barrier?
I don't know.
I never played Fallout 3. Is that terrible of me? I own it and I never played it. I bought it on Steam, so it was like $5 and I didn't.
Last of Us I didn't play because it didn't come out on PC, so I'm not playing it. But I hope it has a great tone and story. And
Last of Us?
Yeah.
It's coming out on PC?
No, I don't know if it is. It's just PlayStation, whatever. So,
my league name is OOVII.
Oh, rubble.
Did you watch Djokovic win in the World Tour Finals? I didn't watch it, but I kept up on the internet to see how it went. I think he still finished second for the year, or not. I thought Nadal's first no matter what. But yeah. Sad to see Federer sixth. Sixth in the world, Roger Federer. Pretty sad.
Is he on his way out?
I guess. I mean, he's like 32 or something.
Yeah,
33 maybe. He has two kids. Really, as soon as he had his children is when he sort of stopped winning Grand Slams. Stopped winning.
What is the agenda for the stream tonight? Well, no plans, except Joel might come on at 9.
Mm-hmm.
That's the plan.
Mm-hmm. Come on, I'm waiting.
Evil Panda, 1988. What city do you live in? He asks, where can I get the best smoked meat sandwich? Are you asking on the globe?
I did catch the WCS Global Finals and some of the semis and stuff. It was pretty cool, actually. The production value was really, really high. I liked the Quinta analyst desk. And the casters did a really good job. I was really impressed with Tasteless. Like everyone came out swinging, really tried to bring it up a notch. I think after the League World Finals and shit, esports is on another level. You can't half-ass any of it. And I thought everyone did a really, really good job. The casters, the analysts, and then and I was cheering super hard for Jadon. I thought it would be so amazing if Jadon could finally win something really big in StarCraft 2. Jadon was one of the most famous players of all time from Brood War, one of the few real champions, and then he moved over to StarCraft 2. And he's come close so many times. I think, man, I don't know how many times he's been right there. And then this is the mega finals. There is no bigger event for the whole year. It's the mega, mega, mega finals BlizzCon. And he got to the grand finals. And it would have been such a great story and so epic. It seems sometimes StarCraft 2 can't catch a break. The game, the scene can't. There's been a few times they could have these really epic story moments, and then they just never happen. And then always some not to discredit SOS or whatever, but he's obviously a great player. But he's compared to Jadon, compared to so many other people in the tournament, he's totally obscure Korean guy.
Mm-hmm.
It's just so hard for everyone to really get behind him, but super nice guy and his play is really solid, but it would have been just so big for the scene to have Jadon win that. It would just have been such a great story, but it was really cool. I actually really enjoyed it. I haven't cheered like that in StarCraft 2 in a long time. PS4, Xbox One, dude, for me it's not even close, man. It's PS4, so far ahead. I don't even understand how anyone's excited for the Xbox One, really.
When is it shipping?
Well, I mean, I understand
shipping
fanboyism inspires a lot of people, but
yeah.
But anyways, yeah, for one, I have a wicked gaming computer. Like, I always have, like, a cutting-edge gaming PC. It's been, like, a decade now. It's a priority in my life. I don't have a car. I don't have a lot of things that people have. I have a nice gaming PC. I can afford myself that life luxury. So I'm never really impressed hardware-wise by consoles. Like, really, they're just access to some exclusive titles that aren't on PC. And sometimes, occasionally, like, they're good for, like, local multiplayer or playing in more social games. Like, my Wii actually got more use than my Xbox 360 by far, just because of, like, the non-gamer kind of people that be over. They want to play Wii bowling, and they want to do, like, simple shit like that. You don't sit down a non-gamer and be like, here's Call of Duty Ghosts. Like, check it out.
Mm-hmm.
but because I never had a PS3, and I kind of, you know, I figure I should get one of them, and the PS4 was just killing it at E3, like, in every single category. And it's, like, $399. It's, I don't know, I hummed and hawed. I actually, even today, I was humming and hawing, like, do I open it or do I just flip it for cash? Because I think there's a demand for these. And there's actually not a single launch title I'm excited to get. So I'm going to have an assistant.
Yeah.
So I'm just like, I could flip it and get it later on or something like that. But, yeah, it's pretty sad. Like, of the launch titles, there's, like, the four big ones. They're all, like, FPSs. It's like, do you have, like, Killzone or Battlefield 4 or Call of Duty Ghosts or on Xbox, it's like Titanfall or this, like, post-apocalyptic FPS with lots of browns and grays. And it's just, like, it's amazing. I look at that lineup, and I don't know if I'm just from a different generation or if other people see that as diversity because the environment changes a bit or the types of weapons you point and shoot at the center of your screen change a bit, but it's, like, it's so close to the same game, like, repeated. And there's such a lack of variety. So things like Drive Club, I was a bit excited, like, really social-ish kind of racer. I thought I'd pick that up, delayed. The only FPS I was kind of excited about was Destiny, because I'm like, it sounds like they're trying to really push the batteries and do something a bit new. I don't know. And it's like the Halo kind of Call of Duty guys in their studio, like, you know, Bungie. Anyway, but I think there's probably, I'll end up playing more indie games, like, on the PS4.
DS9000 graphics.
Yeah, they're right. It's like 1080p, whatever, man. I game at like 2560 by 1440, man, at like 50 billion frames a second. So fucking no console in the world's going to make me go like, ooh. But but you know what? Like, they're high-end gaming PCs are very rare. And I like consoles because they typically have very large install bases. So my more casual-ish friends, chances are they have consoles if they don't have a good gaming PC. And in terms of, even though, like, I've never played a competitive console game or anything like that, of, like, time trial games way back in the day, I really like the idea of everyone having equal hardware in a competitive field, you know?
Yeah.
It's and it's much harder, I think, to hack. Maybe someone in the chat can correct me, but I'm not sure if, you know, aim bots are that easy when you're playing COD on the Xbox 360. Like, do people aim bot their Xboxes? Do they, like, inject some code or do they hook some shit up? Or if that exists? Or... because it's so easy to cheat on PCs. And I found, at least back in the day when I played a lot of FPS, there's just so many fucking cheaters. It's because it's such an easy game to cheat in. Like, it's like, oh, yeah, the instant point your head and kill you. It's like, oh, great.
Yeah.
So, like, yeah.
Cheating still exists in consoles. That Steam had a good way of dealing with it. I can remember they would for sure ban people that were cheating or that it had installed something. It's like, it was just like your whole Steam account's banned. Like, you're just, I like that sort of one or a zero. It's like, oh, you cheated.
It's like cheating.
We're not interested in anything. We're just going to not have you as a customer.
Yeah. With Steam, you could lose access to all the products you bought, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you'd be like, oh, your entire library, which 10, 20, 30 years from now, could be like hundreds and hundreds of dollars, or thousands of dollars in games and DLC. It's like, okay, it's gone because we busted you cheating, which I think is awesome. I like accountability. Accountability generally leads to a bit more moral behavior, but I like the idea of real names and stuff. That's super unpopular opinion.
Mm-hmm.
But there's a game I played on my racing. I got a racing rig and I got into it for about 6 months a couple years ago, and it's called iRacing, and it's like it's the pinnacle of sim racing because I built myself this cool sim rig with like triple monitor. Set up and stuff, and it was all from old scrap parts. I had almost all the parts. It was just like a couple more, sort of a hobby project, putting together this rig. But anyway, so iRacing is super serious. All the tracks are like laser scanned, iRacing, like just the letter I and then racing.com. And it's like a super serious racing community. All the tracks are authentic tracks that exist on planet Earth, like laser scanned to like the millimeter. And professional drivers will use this to sort of memorize the tracks in the off season. Because you want to drive a track like thousands of times till it's just, you could practically do it with your eyes closed, right?
Mm-hmm.
And, but the community is very, very serious. You actually have like an accident rating. Like if you just like bump a guy, well, you suffer points and you can like lose your license and you can like not play anymore or not move up and get to like the decent cars. And one of the most important things you can do is to have a great safety rating. It's probably the single most important thing for the first like 6 months that I ever played the game. It was like about not fucking crashing my shit. It was like trying to be as respectful as possible everyone else while still getting a good time if you have any hope to advance. And what else is cool is it's all real name. Like when you see people, it's just your real name. Everyone's like real name on their car. And it's like, because it's a more mature community. It's mostly like older guys that have the money to put together rigs and do this very old man thing. But it's such a mature community, man. Like it's night and day when you compare a game like League of Legends to like a community like iRacing. And I think the real names probably has something to do with that too, you know?
Oh yeah, it's totally different. I think that you know, sure you want anonymity on the internet and you want, you know, network neutrality, but like maybe League of Legends should have two servers. One's like the real name people, and then
yeah,
the other one is like the whatever people that for some reason don't want to show their real name.
Yeah, honestly, yeah, put right in. It's like Jarett Cale, Toronto,
totally,
Ontario.
Totally different community.
Toronto, Ontario. Like, look me up. Here's my address. With one click away.
Yeah.
So, man.
What are some of the questions we skipped here? Oh, Irish Buds wants to know if we watched his stream, which I did. Did you watch his stream?
Well, I didn't watch 25 hours of
the
stream.
Yeah, I didn't watch the whole thing.
I hopped in now and again quite a number of times. I hopped in. I was actually quite busy that day, unfortunately, but no, I checked it out sometimes. And then Wyman was last Saturday as well.
Every time I went on, it was Dota, so it wasn't as exciting to me because I don't know that game very well. But I should know that game because it's a great game. We talked about this before, why we played LoL and not Dota.
It was all Dota. I don't know who's walking around in the background. It's not my little guy, unless he snuck out of bed, but he's never done that before, so that would be a first and very cute, and I wouldn't care. Well, I'm waiting for the day he sneaks out of bed. Like, you know, that moment where you look and he's like hiding on the corner and runs away and, you know.
He's staying up and it's awesome. And
yeah, he's sneaking on the house listening to the adults' conversations. Like, what are they talking about?
Yeah.
You have a nice place, Jarett. I wish this was my place. this is unfortunately not my place. I am staying in an extra room here as I'm trying to find a place to live. I'm technically homeless, although they're kind enough to let me use their house as a mailing address too. So no, I just had to leave my last place and we're just looking for our new place right now. So we're transitional right now. This place is worth like, yeah, it's very nice. It's a very nice condominium in downtown Toronto. Easy.
Yeah, good location.
Yeah.
We're looking at Lake Ontario right now.
Yeah. It's pretty crazy. Yeah. I think it'd be a long time before I have a place like this. No. I'm here. The whole family's here. We're shacked up in this wing of the condo. We should be gone really soon, though. I can't wait to actually have my own house back. It's a pretty terrible spot to be in, to not have a home.
To be homeless, to not be paying any rent.
I don't want to talk
it's just
about
terrible.
Oh, I dude, you know what? That's funny. You'd think that I would see that silver lining, but no. I think the complete lack of privacy and personal space in my office and my little home studio and just all my stuff. I really miss my stuff. It's all in storage. So we're sort of here. Like, I'm pretty much...
this is bare bones existence.
Yeah, like I've been backpacking basically for like 2 months now plus. So
Backpacking in 2015 means a pimp PC.
That's what I brought.
A massive monitor.
Yeah, PC.
Yeah. Bunch of Razer gear.
Yeah, I'm a gypsy man. People are asking for our Steam names. I think my Steam name is Ubi too. I don't know.
I can't remember what mine is. It's something longer, so I don't want to give the wrong one. I can't tell you right now.
All I need is a computer and a mattress. Honestly, that's basically what I have. Like, I my pimp PC, and I'm sharing a desk here. I've kind of just huddled into this side of his desk, the owner of the apartment. And then I threw my mattress on the floor into the room. We sleep on the floor on our mattress. Because it's a very nice mattress. I believe you should invest a lot in your mattress. But that's pretty much all I've got. So it's actually kind of funny. In terms of movie updates, sorry, I'm not trying to ignore the guidance. That's movie updates. We still haven't gotten a camera, so we're still just trying to lock the script.
Yeah, the script is pretty awesome.
It is amazing. But is there anything else we can just mention, like behind the scenes? Like what? Like, I just feel bad not having something more juicy than...
People are asking what we're going to shoot on. I don't know if we're going to do the red or the scarlet because... the scarlet or the epic because... It's not very mockumentary wieldy, like it's, you know, we want a run and gun type camera. We might go with the Canon C300 or, you know, C500 if we think we can afford that. But yeah, I don't know. We're going to keep it run and gun, but there's a lot of great cameras out there that will make the quality amazing. And the other question we have to talk about is, do we shoot it in 4K or do we shoot it in 1080p? Because 4K... then we have it for all time and we can cut the movie in 4K and the movie's in 4K.
Yeah.
Right. And then it's like, you know, 5 years from now, it's like, what is this new 1080p resolution? Yeah. Like, oh, it's gross. It's pure movies only in 1080p.
You make it like 20-year future proof.
Yeah. And then if we had spent 10 grand more on the camera, we could have a 4K movie and then, you know, show it in theaters and with a 4K projector and for all time have it be 4K. So, yeah, we're going to have to see.
Right? Exactly. 4K televisions already out, 16Ks in development, of course, right? And
yeah.
But that's the thing.
It's
so
too many Ks.
It's not future-proof, but it's more future-proof. The fact is 4K TVs are already being produced at a price point that the highest-end consumers are buying them. So, like, literally, 4K will be the average TV in your Best Buy that people are going to be getting. And probably, like, well, by the end of this console type cycle, it'll be like 5-6 years, I bet, and people will be like, you don't, your TV's not 4K. People buy shit they don't need, like, all the time. Like, even look at 3D on TVs, man.
That's how much 3D are you watching?
Dude, like, I was seriously, it was like last week when there's a huge news program. They've taken time out of the CBC News to pitch 4K TVs to the public or something, some paid advertising spot. And I'm just sitting there watching as they're pitching the technology behind this TV, and it's in, you know, Future Shop right now, buy it, only $10,000. There does not exist content for it. Mm-hmm. There's nothing you can fucking put on it that runs at 4K. What? Is the point.
And digital raw, the price point and the technology is going to get better and crappier in like 2 years from now when there's finally maybe enough 4K content to maybe watch.
To maybe make worthwhile.
Like honestly, it's beyond Blu-ray resolution. And like, you can't walk into a store and buy 4K content, you know?
No, it doesn't exist.
In fact, YouTube does 4K.
Yeah.
But of course, it's very compressed. The data rate is balls.
Well, people don't have 4K monitors, man, so they're watching what they're going to scroll over as they want.
Yeah. I mean, really.
I mean, like, 1920 by 1080 is, like, that's just the standard monitor resolution right now. It's not going to change anytime soon. Mm-hmm. 4K is, like, big TV, sure, but it's going to be a while, I think, before, say, this monitor is 4K.
And also, like you don't need the pixels on a monitor this size. Like, what is this, 24 inches?
This is 24 inches, yeah.
So if you made this 4K... like the resolution and perception of your eyeballs. In fact, unless a fucking eagle is watching your monitor, they're not going to know the difference.
Like, my really nice monitor, my gorgeous monitor that I don't have hooked up right here because I don't have a home, the 1440p one, the 256 by 1440. I can't use it. 256 by 1440. I can't use it. I can't use it on this desk because the desk isn't deep enough and it's too close to me. It's like, and everything's just.
It's too big.
It doesn't make sense. Yeah,
music. Yeah, you need like a 40-inch monitor for 4K, and then, you know, you're at, well, I don't know what the, you know. what the point is, where you wouldn't be noticing the difference in pixels because of the limitations of your eyeballs. But
yeah, and what's funny too is that even in this era of 1080p, when, like, I mean, 720p TVs haven't been sold for a while, right? Brand new, like, new models, like maybe 2009, 2010. It's been 1080p for, like, years and years and years. 1080p, like, monitors.
Yeah.
Fucking Call of Duty Ghosts on the Xbox One, 720p.
What?
Yeah, man.
On the Xbox One?
Yeah, but not the PS4. But there's tons
what?
Of... Well, there's tons of Xbox One games. Like, this generation, brand new generation games that are 720p. And a huge chunk of them in the last generation that are still 720p. They're not even making the 1080p, so it's better get a 4K TV. That shit, man.
Wow, that's ridiculous. I can't. Well, I guess it just must be keeping the price down, keeping the processor low.
Yeah, yeah. BF4 is 900p. That's right.
Well, that's why I'm waiting for the PC version of it, the GTA 4 or whatever. Well, that's 1080p. But it was a funny comment on Reddit. Someone said, "I'd like to thank all of the console players for beta testing GTA 4." For the PC master race.
Seriously, yeah.
Working all the bugs, making it great so that we can play it. And,
yeah, no, it's. Yeah, should I sell my PS4? I don't know. That's the big question. I could make a bit of money. I don't think I'm going to use it for anything. I don't know. Actually, you know, I'll confirm with the chat, because there's always guys that definitely know in the chat. But on the PS4, on the PlayStation Network, when I go to, like, download and buy, like, indie games, can I buy any of the games that were on the PS3, like Wipeout and stuff and all that stuff that's been coming out for years and years and years? Or does that none of that work because it's not backwards compatible, so there's going to be a brand new market of, like, 5 games and shit? Like, is, no, you can't. Wow, fuck me. Like, I think, yeah, see. Nope. Never mind. There are not at launch. Yeah, maybe in the future. I don't know. We didn't make plans to use the PS4 because we thought we would have been shooting by now. We didn't think we would have a window to have it in our early plans when we started writing. So it wasn't even like an option or a consideration. And but now that it's possible, it's like, I don't know if I want to start lawyering up Sony.
You have to get permission to use the product, and it's a long process.
And Sony Japanese companies like Sony, Nintendo, those aren't easy companies to reach out to. You got a company like Razer or a company like or any like the event companies, IMs, like they're so approachable there. But Nintendo is just a wall, man. I think Sony's a wall. And you got to get global rights to it, and they don't want to offend anyone in any culture. Like, they look at them, like, hey, what's me? What's another guy? And he gets really excited, and he's toxic, and he humps things. It's kind of like, I don't associate that with Nintendo products. Which was kind of what happened with the TV show, I think, right? We tried to get
something. Yeah, we talked to Nintendo Canada, and they were like, sure, we'll do it. And then it's like, as long as it's only in Canada. And we're like, as long as the Pwnage TV show is only in Canada, really, so... Either we have Nintendo products in the episode and we don't ever release it outside of Canada, or we have to talk to Nintendo Japan, which even the Nintendo guy in Canada said is impossible. So there's no way. It's like trying to explain, like, oh, there's a Canadian TV show and there's a guy that humps his monitor and, you know, they want to use it. It's like, what? I don't know.
Yeah. Nintendo's not so much about humping stuff.
Yeah, not really. So we're not even going to waste our time trying.
Speaking of Nintendo, though, I got excited by something that it's really like, it's something that Dave and I used to dream existed like 7 years ago or 6 years ago, whenever the Wii first came out. I don't know if we talked about this on stream, but Dave from the show got super addicted to Wii Tennis. And we took the game to another level. Like, we broke the meta and broke the meta until you realize that, like, the best serve is the lowest underhand serve possible. And you know, because everything else is, you could have an unreturnable return. Even on the super serve, you can actually return that such that the guy cannot get your return if it's timed perfectly. So, and we got so good at timing it that you could no longer get a super serve. So not even that. And if you miss your super serve and you get a normal serve, well, that's an easy free point. There's a huge window to get a free point in your swing. And anyway, so we just took this game to the next level. Loved it, played it tons. Did that thing at DivX, remember?
Mm-hmm.
We actually had a booth at DivX 1 year, and we sat there and played like 35 groups of people, and I just kicked the fuck out of everybody. didn't drop a game.
Mm-hmm.
So anyways, I got the Wii Tennis skills. We tried to take it to an event, actually, at Blur Cinema. We played some Wii Tennis for a while. Some noobs, smashed some noobs. And anyway, long story short, I had to just talk out my Wii Tennis skills for a couple seconds there. They brought out Wii Sports Club. I didn't know this. I just randomly turned my Wii U because every now and again I get this, like, almost OCD need to turn on all my things, like load Steam, just to make sure everything's updated.
Mm-hmm.
So I turn on my Wii U like once a month and dust it off. I'm like, I should system update this. Anyway, and then I see that they have Wii Sports Club, and they've made it, they've remade it. So here's what I'm doing. They've remade it. It's live as service. There's no disc game. Nintendo made it as a live as service, a HD remake of Wii Sports, except they release one sport at a time. The only two they've released so far are the only two that really fucking matter, bowling and tennis.
Mm-hmm.
And you can pay $2, $1.99, a day to rent it. Access to all the games.
Or how
and,
much
and there's going to be five games. They're remaking all five games, but really no one played anything but tennis bowling. Or you can pay $10 to unlock one game forever. So if you want all five games, it's a $50 game. A really mm-hmm. simple game on their end to make. Like, you compare this to making a Pokemon.
It reminds me of Atari. Like,
close.
$50 for Wii Sports.
But I think it's very interesting. I don't know if it's going to work out for them, but for me personally, it's perfect because I only really wanted tennis. And then I'm sure there'll be a night when a bunch of people will be over, they want to play bowling, and then someone will drop 10 bucks and whatever. I mean, I would never spend $10 for the other three sports. But 20 bucks for me, unlimited. And then get this. So not, it's not just an HD update of a game that I had a lot of fun playing, especially people that come over, because it's such an easy and accessible game. It's online with rankings now. So now you can go online. This is when I got back to the original point me and Dave used to dream of. If Dave and I could have just gone online and spanked bitches online in Wii Tennis and had a global ranking and regional ranking system, dude, would have been a better life for us. It would have been a much better life for us. And now it's here. So, yeah, just last night I downloaded it. In fact, I was like 10 to 10. I'm like, man, I would love to. And if I had my own home, I would. But the problem is there's people living in me.
We'd stream some Wii Tennis.
No, I would have seriously tonight streamed me kicking people's ass online in Wii Tennis. And that shit's happening. As soon as I'm not a homeless man and have some space, I'm going to set up my Wii, I'm going to put the camera, and I'm just going to spank bitches online in Wii Tennis. I'll spank all you bitches. I'll spank any motherfucker. That's
how, you know.
Jarett, log on to Steam right now. Okay, I'm logging out of Steam right now. Uh-oh. If you beat me in Wii Tennis, dude, I will destroy you.
Says Pipson.
I will destroy you.
Oh, Irish Spuds has sent you a gift.
The fuck is this?
I know how much you like ponies. Here you go. The secret of magic crystals.
Did you spend money on this?
In this game, you manage a horse breeding farm set in a fantasy surrounding. The game enables you to breed legendary horses such as Pegasus, Unicorn, Fire Steed.
Dude, I can...
Demon Steed.
Oh, I can breed unicorns, man.
You can buy over 700
objects. I can buy over 700 objects for DLC.
Mate, are you going to accept the gift or decline the gift?
I can decline a gift. What happens, man?
He probably gets refunded.
Do you get refunded? I should probably give you your money back.
Maybe it was a dollar, but... doesn't tell you.
Because let's be realistic here. The secret of the magic crystals.
Maybe you should watch the trailer before you accept the gift.
This is like, man, even if I had like a young daughter, I don't know if I'd subject her to this.
Your bunny.
I'm kind of tempted to play it though. Which Uvi is the real one? Uh-oh.
Stream the game, people are saying. You're going to stream Pony Magic Crystals? And become a unicorn speedrunner, says Bossa Nova. We're gonna watch the we should stream the oh, there it is. $5.
$5. Damn it, that was the perfect price point where I still can't decide now. It's funny you can decline a gift. This guy's back. We kind of mentioned, really, are we looking into getting beta? I mean, I checked my box as soon as it was announced at BlizzCon. I quickly hit that link, logged into my account, and checked the beta, which is all I did for Hearthstone, and I got in Hearthstone. I got randomly locked in. I didn't get hooked up or anything. I hope that happens again, man. I hope it's like a chronological list, because I was pretty fast getting in there, man, so... Pretty fast. Did you sign up on your account?
Not yet.
Fucking new.
My origin password, I can't remember.
Origin? It's freaking BattleNet.
Oh, yeah, BattleNet.
You know what? I don't play ranked Hearthstone. I don't really get Hearthstone. I understand the game and how to play it, but I force myself to play it. I don't enjoy it yet.
Did you get the beta?
I did, yeah. I got the beta a couple weeks ago.
Oh, you didn't tell me.
And for one, there's a couple types of strategies that I play against that feel very frustrating. Like, there's not much counterplay, and you even know what's coming. You're playing a priest, he's got fucking 9 cards in his hand. You're like, oh, shit. Can't put up my big creature because you'll take it, or... You know, can't do this. It's like your play is predictable, but you're left with like no options, and you don't know you're gonna play a priest before the game because it's just like random. Mm-hmm. And maybe if you could build like a pure anti-priest deck, maybe like tons of tiny minions. I don't know.
I guess it's still the alpha, right? Or it's still the beta.
It's still the alpha. But anyways, but really the problem is that maybe it's because I played years and years of Magic, but it's just kind of a simpler form of Magic, and I feel like been there, done that on the card thing. Like for 20 years now, and there's nothing like new and awesome enough to get me to want to play it. So when I look at all the cards I have to collect, and so what I do is, so basically, because some things take a fostered love, some things are acquired tastes, and I'm giving it my time. So instead of just stopping playing it after the first couple days, and they've got a great system. They have like a first win of the day system, kind of like League of Legends, which is a great way to just kind of bring you back. But they have quests that you get one quest a day. But, which is so awesome, they let you stack 3 quests. So you only have to play like every third day, pretty much, if you were to blank your quests. but because when you have 3 quests at a time, you're doing them more efficiently because some of them overlap. Some quests might be like win 5 games as a mage, and the other quest is win 2 games as a mage or a druid. So you're like, oh, fuck, I can play a mage and knock out both at the same time. So I only play Hearthstone when my quest log is full, until I knock off one of the quests, at which point I stop. And then the next day or whenever I'm next board, I'll log in, my quest thing will be full, I'll play till I have a quest, and then I've slowly picked up packs of cards this way, and my decks are kind of okay. I've got a few purples and some blues in my main couple of decks that I like playing. They're okay, but even when I'm playing and winning, I don't feel all that great, and I feel like I should have just played something else or something.
Interesting.
But I tuned into BlizzCon. Artosis, it was the first ever Hearthstone tournament at BlizzCon.
Mm-hmm.
It was an invitational, and Artosis won that motherfucker. So,
wow.
Go Dan, pretty
nice.
Fucking funny. 85,000 people were watching when I tuned in, and that wasn't even the finals yet. I didn't catch the finals.
Wow.
85,000 people. The grand finals for StarCraft 2, I think, on the Twitch stream was like 134. So I mean, it's like it wasn't far off. And this game's in beta. Like most people don't even have it. And I couldn't believe the numbers of people watching basically in RNG. You know, just people rolling dice, kind of. Finals up to 100K, yeah. Yeah, Artosis' jacket was the best, man. I wish I saw it live. He just had an over-the-top, like, esports jacket. Like, he'd swear he was...
Was it like the Don
Flash
Cherry?
Flash or Boxer or somebody. Kind of.
Google image search that shit.
Artosis, Hearthstone. Let's see how good Google is here. There.
What is he? The driving race cars?
I know, it's so ridiculous.
So where did he get this from?
He is sponsored by TT Esports and stuff. Yeah, the StarCraft 2 seems very weird though. The casters are actually bigger than the players. It's very weird.
Really? Wow. That's interesting.
Yeah, it's – Oh, yeah. No, I guess in the last stream, it had just happened before the last stream, the Generals 2 cancellation.
Yes. Yeah.
So we had that on stream. So I don't know if you guys know this, because I talk about Generals 2 all the time in my excitement. Because, again, I mentioned it a billion times before, but Command and Conquer Generals was the most fun I've ever had playing an RTS. It could have been the moment in my life or the people I was playing it with. There's a ton of other factors that might have gone into it. I don't know if I were to go back and play it now. It stands the test of time. I know the engine was kind of clunky.
Mm-hmm.
But it really was a magical game at that point in my life. So anyways, when the sequel's announced, and that's going to, you have to get a little bit excited, even though it's going to be made by EA.
Mm-hmm.
And if you didn't know, EA outright canned the game and fired everybody at the studio. They could have closed the studio down. I think, not fire. I guess they're finding a lot of them work in other studios, but they disbanded the studio and canceled the game outright because it wasn't going in the direction that they thought it would, I guess,
mm-hmm.
or something.
And the fans were wanting or whatever, so it was
yeah.
like a big,
yeah.
like, we're making the wrong shit. Like, we're just going to,
yeah.
like, put it on
and,
the shelf.
And in the release, they talk about how it didn't have cinematic cutscenes with Kane and all the shit. What's really funny is because, you know, that's the shit I never cared about. Like, I understand the average Command & Conquer fan really likes that stuff and cares about it. The average person that buys their products, which they have to consider, you know, principally. But I didn't. And so they're basically like, nah, I'm not going to make a Generals 2. We're going to go back to, like, cutscenes and I'll focus on the single player and a $60 box copy in a store. And, like, to me, it's
yeah, they they realized that, well, I don't know. I don't want to speculate too much in a mean way, but they might have realized that, like, to have a free-to-play model where microtransactions are where you make your money, the game has to be quality.
Yeah.
Right. Whereas if you want to rely on a brand and you can sell $60 off the top and then not worry about any money after that, you can rely on just Kane being in it and Command & Conquer and someone's going to play a single player.
Mm-hmm.
Wasn't there some stat that like 80% or whatever people never pressed the multiplayer button on Command & Conquer?
Yeah. And this that holds true for StarCraft 2 as well. Blizzard pushed out. I think it was higher than 80%, but I think Blizzard, there was like 90 or 95% or something of people that purchased outright $60 StarCraft 2 that never went online or never played more than one game or something. A lot of people play like one game and get smashed, and that's the last time they play online.
Yeah, they just play the single player campaign. They enjoy it. They watch the cutscenes, and then they spend the $60 and they feel satisfied and they go about their lives. So if you want people to persistently be playing for 5 years and buying things, microtransactions, the multiplayer gameplay has to be so appealing that that's 90% of what people are doing with your game.
And in that case, your game needs to be free to play or have that persistent monetization model that League of Legends has or Dota has, because there's no incentive for the publisher or developer to support the game for 5 years if everyone has already bought the game 5 years ago. They're not bringing in revenue. And in fact, I think my biggest frustration with the whole Generals 2 thing wasn't so much the game, because the game had its faults for sure in the UI and everything, but that's all fixable. But man, like, the community couldn't let the free-to-play thing go, and all these ignorant fuckheads running around, just like it was the end of the world that Command & Conquer is going to free-to-play, as though it's impossible to make a game free-to-play and an RTS at the same time or something. It's like, maybe not the way they were doing it, but to never consider another way, like, don't, no more experimentation, give up, is like, it's you're basically accepting the death of RTS, because early, you know, that's still persistent playing it for years and years, competitive RTS, because I think even Blizzard's not going to go down that path again. I think StarCraft 2 will probably be the last time they do a traditional, like, 1990 style RTS, because these days you make games like Hearthstone. And you make games like League of Legends, you make games like World of Warcraft. Look at all the iPad games they're making, like the Supercell, which made Clash of Clans on the iPad, which you probably never play because it's a total fucking piece of shit, pay to win. They just sold 50% of their company for $1.5 billion.
I thought you were gonna say million. I was gonna be like, whoa.
No.
Then you said billion, and I was like,
billion.
That's a thousand times my expectations.
Yes, it's a Finnish company. Their company was valued at $3 billion, and they sold half to some huge Japanese mobile development firm. People underestimate how much money there is in making
and pay-to-win.
And pay-to-win and just noob shit everywhere. The ultra-casual gamer that has a disposable income that doesn't give a fuck about the gameplay integrity, and et cetera. Anyways.
I wonder if you made a game that was literally just a
movie. Sorry, I,
You made a point, sorry.
I just want to, I think Clash of Clans is pay to win. I didn't play Clash of Clans, but I played games that were similar to it, and they were 100% pay to win. So I just assumed it was. But, so.
Clash of Clans is pay to win, someone asks.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
You know, I like, if you made a game, mobile app, and you spent some money promoting it or whatever, and it was like, it was called pay to win, and it was like, your opponent pays $25.
Counter with,
it's like 35. Counter with $26. It's like counter with 27.
Yeah.
And then it's like, you win, and fireworks appear, and then it's like, you lose. Like,
yeah.
It's like, okay, so start there. Maybe that would not make a lot of money. Maybe it will make some money as a joke. But then you just add some game element that's like stupid, like who can like push the ball over the hoop, and then if you pay more, you get more advantage pushing the ball over the hoop, you know, whatever. Like, you know, just start, and then, you know, turn up the like skill knob, but start from zero skill. Start from just pure pay to win. I think that might be a pretty funny experiment. And then at some point the knob stops and becomes less profitable. So like, I wonder what you know, gameplay / skill versus pay to win level is the optimal amount. It's
to make money. It's like, pretty high on the pay to win. I think
it's pretty high. Like, but it's not 100%, right? It's like, you know, you're making a recipe, you know, you don't want to have all sugar. You got to have some eggs and flour in there, but the sugar sure as hell like sells it, you know,
yeah.
the crepe or whatever you're making.
That's my point. I wouldn't consider for a second in the year 2013 and beyond, if I was a game publisher or developer, which I hope to be maybe involved in some of that in the future, I wouldn't consider making a product that is not live as service, that is not persistent forever, that is certainly not the box, thanks for your $60 up front, I'll never see you again. no consideration. It has to be free. You have to give it. Man, like, see, you're selling crack. You can't walk around and say, hey, do you want to be a crackhead, man? It's only $500. Can you be a crackhead and lose like teeth? No one's going to buy, man.
Mm-hmm.
But you're like, hey, you just try the crack. Just experience the crack.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe you like the crack. Maybe you won't. All of a sudden, you're going to have a lot more crackheads and a lot of them.
Probably like the crack if you try it.
Probably like the crack.
Yeah.
No barriers to entry. And then you have to create a service that people want to pay money for, that it's good enough for. And it makes you make a good service. You can't get lazy.
Mm-hmm.
And it holds your feet to the fire. You know, you've got to make sure your gameplay is tight. Your game is evolving. You know, League's always evolving, right? They're constantly doing visual updates on old characters to make sure their animations and graphics, everything, like everything, just always slowly pushing forward. And you almost don't even notice it unless you take a screenshot and then go back like 2 years, go look at League Season 1. You're like, holy shit, it looks like a piece of shit. You didn't even feel it all updating.
It was also gradual.
Yeah.
It's like getting fat. Like, you just don't notice how fat your friend gets if you see them every day. But
thanks, dude. I know you're gone. Fuck it. I get it, man. I get it. Yeah.
Just...
It's a subtle director's way to let it. It's like, by the way.
No. But hey, I was going to say something else about crack. Someone says the crack analogy. This is just, we got crack on the brain because we're in Toronto, right? I don't know if you guys heard, but there's a lot of Toronto crack going on, especially in the mayor's office. And Jarett's sucking in his cheeks and
Blue
Steel.
Blue Steel.
But yeah, man, I don't know if you guys know about Rob Ford, but he was in the media. That's a good Blue Steel. Someone screenshot this. There you go.
I'm being you on Todd Merlot right now.
On Todd Merlot?
Bonjour. Just be very sexy.
But hey, you know, the funny thing with Rob Ford is that what the international media doesn't really discuss or touch on is that everyone knew in Toronto he's an idiot. He's a moron. Everyone knew that.
This guy, man.
It's clear he's a moron. I think even morons think he's a moron. But he was just so adamant about saving tax money that he got votes from, like, around downtown Toronto. So he is a fool, and I think even he knows he's a fool at this point.
No, I think he's
and
losing,
so
but he won't.
so the world media is like, oh my god, the mayor of Toronto smokes crack, and Toronto's like, yeah, Probably does. Like, you know, like it's not a surprise. It's not like it's funny. Every talk show host, every late night talk show host says, "So the mayor of Toronto has admitted to this," and it's like, "I have smoked crack," and everyone laughs in the audience. They laugh, and it's like the fact that he smokes crack is a joke and is laughable. It's like, "Oh my god, yeah, well, he said that," and it's like Toronto's like, "Yeah, we probably figured that. Yeah, we knew. Yeah, like it's not funny." It's like, "Yeah, dude, like you smoke crack."
It's so much more than crack. Like it's so much more than crack.
It's just general idiot life, and.
Yeah, so I mean, like, just Google YouTube, you know, Rob Ford quotes. Like, he's,
yeah,
it's really fucking amazing how stupid this man is. Even his speechwriter's stupid. Like, assuming that he's reading the words in the paper, it's written by, like, a six-year-old. Like, literally a six-year-old. I don't know if it's his brother or his relative he hired or somebody. But I would love to engage this guy in a public forum. Like, I'd love to debate Rob Ford personally, just as a taxpaying.
It's a taxpayer.
Metro Toronto area.
You can call into his radio show, you know. But like someone said, late night audiences laugh at everything. That's true. But
it's funny that this guy says this, JDJD11 says Jared for mayor, because I want to announce my candidacy
for mayor. I'm changing my name Toronto. To can't be worse than Rob Ford.
Yeah, so I'm going to make a poster and it's going to say, doesn't smoke crack. Like this guy. It's a pretty good start, right?
It's a good start.
Pretty good start. I'll drop Reddit memes around. You know, I'll drop that Bill Murray one. You know?
Which one? Oh, at least I don't smoke crack.
I don't smoke crack. Got that
going for me.
That's pretty good. Anyway, use my Che Jeremy pick. I am actually really tempted.
This is really wow, this guy.
I'm becoming more and more political in the last few years of my life, and I want to take that passion and be more active with it. Because I kind of want to either flee North America or work
or
to
fight
or fight and actually and change something. And there was just recently there was a guy in Florida, I think in South Miami or Miami Beach, Steve Burke. He was like a comedian and he had like a parody campaign last election, like 4 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And he actually made a couple of videos. One of them went pretty viral. I remember seeing on Reddit like a couple of years ago. And he ran again this time. I think he finished second or something, but you know, he had a lot of attention, a lot of people on him, and it's inspiring. You know what? Actually, the most inspiring is looking at Iceland. There, the mayor of Reykjavik, which is the majority of the population of the country of Iceland, they elected. Coming into their mayoral election, they had politics just like we've all experienced in probably all of us here. It's like the classic airhead politicians, the talking points, et cetera, nothing ever really said, nothing ever really changing. And and he and some comedian friends, he was a stand-up comedian, heavily influenced by Bill Hicks, passionate political stand-up comedian, very funny man. He decides he's going to run for mayor, and his campaign staff and everybody are comedians, and his artistic friends, musicians, just amongst the artists, local Reykjavik artists, and they prop up John Nahr, this comedian, and he's going to run for mayor. And so it's very easy to run for mayor. I don't know if you know this, but they, you know, you go to a website, they have every single point that he needs to have. He needs $200. It's only $200. You run for fucking mayor of Toronto.
Mm-hmm.
And so he signs up 5 months before the election. Now most people campaign for like 2 years and there's this and that. 5 months for election, he's like, he registers, here's my party. He calls it the best party.
Mm-hmm.
Fucking name, the best party. And then all of a sudden, he gets to engage these people in debates. And guess what? He's actually pretty fucking smart and funny. And it turns out that when you engage these people in public work, like, they can't really keep up because they have their talking points and that's all they really got. And so he ends up winning like a lot of public favor because he's funny and smart. And once he starts getting the airtime where people come to his cause, and what seemed like a joke that he was literally made fun of and is made fun of by the other politicians.
He became mayor.
It swayed so much that by the day before the election that he finally was ahead of the polls and he won and became the mayor of Iceland. And he's of Reykjavik. And he's currently the mayor of Reykjavik, Iceland. He's just actually announced that he won't be running for a second term, which is super sad. But because he needs to go and pursue evidence. Now, if you don't know anything about this guy, it's J-O-N, and his last name is Narr, G-N-A-R-R. Totally Google this guy and read about some of his quotes. Did you know that before he'd give interviews about his politics in the election,
mm-hmm.
he would make sure or bring up with the reporter that they understood that The Wire was the greatest dramatic television series of all time.
Yes.
And he would discuss The Wire.
Yeah.
in detail until they accepted that, yes, this is the greatest dramatic television series of all time, which I also totally agree with. And I think that's just so fucking funny. It's just an element of the comedy that he brought.
Yeah, well, you know, in fact, I was going to mention The Wire when I think I was going when you said he's not running again. I was going to mention that scene in The Wire. Remember when Carchetti talks to the ex-mayor, and he talks about his mayoral experience, about how,
well, the police commissioner came up and said, "Here's a bowl." He said, "That's a nice bowl. What's in it?" He said, "Shit." He's like, "You need to eat that shit." And remember that scene?
Yeah.
And he's like doing this whole analogy, but like, he brought a really nice bowl to my office and it was full of shit and I had to eat it. Then this guy came to my office and I had to eat his shit. And then I was eating shit all day. And that was like his story, his wisdom about like what it's like being mayor.
Yeah.
It's like, you got to put up with a lot of shit. Yeah. You got to eat a lot of shit.
Eat your bowl of shit, man. Yeah. No, that's why I think you have to have a good sense of humor to deal with that. You know?
Oh, yeah.
You got to take your shit and laugh it off.
Yeah, Iceland is a great society. I visited there. I had a great time over 10 days and toured the country. And it's quite a tourism experience. If I could plug that, if you're looking for a place for vacation, go to Iceland. It's not icy, especially in the summer. It's nice. So they call it Niceland because it's bad marketing to have ice in the name of your country. But it is a tourism economy that is not sufficiently developed, that it's like Las Vegas, where they just take as much money out of you as possible and then send you on your way with the minimum experience. They actually want to show you a good time. and it is, it's an amazing culture, an amazing country. I could talk for the next half hour about it.
Can you talk for 3 minutes while I get another
I'll drink? Talk for 3 minutes about it.
Do you need a refill?
I do, actually. Or a coffee. Yeah, I forgot what I was going to say about Iceland and their politics. You know, when that whole meltdown happened with the banking and all that, the world economy took a big tank, and it was because of some bankers leveraging mortgages, creating a housing crisis because they had no foresight and were all just individual malprofit. So in Iceland, there were some bankers that fucked a bunch of shit up in a similar way. And I'm less familiar with the details as in the U.S. crisis, but they were doing a bunch of shady deals and lending money and lending it back. And I can't be too articulate on that matter. But anyway, all the bankers went to jail. So Iceland put them in jail because at the end of the whole fiasco, Iceland owed foreign banks and foreign companies so much money that it was about $50,000 per person in Iceland. So can you imagine a small group of bankers make a bunch of deals with international banks and they lose and they gamble and they lose. And then the country is stuck with the debt and it's 50,000. It's like, oh, by the way, you on the street owe $50,000 and so does your son and so does your wife and so does your friend. Everybody owes $50,000 in Iceland because it's only 300,000 people in the country. So they said, oh, fuck you. You shouldn't have dealt with these people. European banks, we're not paying. We're putting those people in jail. It was a crime, and therefore we don't owe anything. So that was the solution to that. And, you know, it's remarkable that they put them in jail when, you know, all of the other criminals, or I guess it depends on your philosophical definition of the law. But if you're stirring shit up and making a bunch of people's lives shittier, and that's what you do for a living, and that's how you made a whole bunch of money, it's pretty bad. But I went to Iceland. I don't know if there's good weed in Iceland because I figured they don't grow a lot of shit there. There's great lamb
in Iceland.
It's amazing, yeah.
Is anyone from the chat from Iceland? Are there any Icelanders in the chat?
Yeah, it's the most literate society, the most internet accessed society.
The highest average happiness, the highest women's rights and freedoms, and then it's like every single category that they measure for human social progression, Icelanders seem to be ahead of everything.
And the genetic base is all Scandinavian, Viking type DNA. And It is to the point where it's remarkable. Before I went to Iceland, somebody told me in Iceland, every woman looks like they stepped off the cover of Vogue. And I was like, oh, there's attractive women in Iceland, okay. And so I go there. And it is to the point where there's a different culture with attractiveness. And so.
You guys should be on the payroll of tours of Iceland. I know, seriously, I don't know if you guys know what's in Iceland, but all the chicks, unbelievable.
But
Like,
to the point where I saw you go to a pub and there's four insanely hot professional model looking girls that are sitting around a pub at a table. I literally saw this and I was like, oh, there's attractive girls over there. And they're having pints and they're playing a board game because it's like they're going out to the pub to play a board game. And no one's talking to them and no one's bothering them. And all the guys are at home playing video games. And there's these amazingly attractive girls just sitting there. And they're just like, oh, fuck. Oh. It's like, what do you want to do? I don't know. There's nothing to do. Like, let's just go out play a game at the pub. I'm just like, okay. And then no one bothers. It's like, and that's the culture. Because all the guys, when, as a male, like, young man, late teens, early 20s. If every girl at school is smoking amazing, attractive, it's like, well, whatever, I'll just play some games. I'll probably, like, have sex with a hot girl, like, tomorrow by accident. Like, it's like, whatever. Like, all the guys in Iceland are, like, just like, whatever. I'm just like, isn't everyone hot in the world? Like, they're just like, and so they don't, like, pursue. They don't, like, oh my God, look at that hot girl over there. Like, I can go talk to her. That doesn't happen. It's like, one will probably fall on my dick, like, in
well, I don't
another
know if
5 minutes.
that
Like,
necessarily happens here either. Like, oh my God, but
but it's like, I don't know, if you meet somebody as a friend at a party and she's attractive or whatever,
you know,
you're
they have
like,
the highest artists per capita in the world too, apparently.
oh
The highest
yeah.
number of like musicians per capita, writers per capita. It's the amount of bands they put out, writers, like, it's hilarious. Like, they have, I think they have a third of a million people, like 330,000-ish people, I think. And they continually pump out world-class artists. Like, it's amazing. Anyway, if they would have me, I'd probably move there. I'd be down with that. But I don't know what I would do there.
The flip side of the coin, which is it's a very small place, and Reykjavik is like the main city, and it's like a small town. Like, I don't know, even Google population of Reykjavik, I think it's 200,000 or whatever. But like, it's, we were there for 10 days, and we spent a lot of time in Reykjavik, and we started recognizing people on the street. We're like, oh, it's that guy that we saw at the pub that day. Like, so like, you can spend 10 days there and see Iceland and then be like, I've seen Iceland, right? Whereas France, you go to France, you're not going to do that France in 10 days, right? But so if you live there, but not like you've got to be a tourist mentality when you live there, but if you live there, I don't know, might be pretty nice. And people think it's colder, but it's on the water. It's an island. It doesn't get too cold. It doesn't get below 10 degrees ever, which is whereas Canada, it's like a minus 40 and the Prairie
What? It
Freeze.
doesn't get below 10 degrees?
Yeah. Well, what do you expect? It's on it's a water island.
I
It's like,
expected slightly colder than Toronto, and I was willing to accept that sacrifice.
no, as far as I understand. Anyway, well, correct me if I'm wrong, but
Dude, that's the moment it happened. It was this moment. I'm
yeah, it doesn't
moving.
get too cold,
I'm moving to Iceland.
but it's just consistently cold. Right, there's no Chinooks, there's no, like,
Yeah, as soon as the movie's done.
yeah, like Victoria Island.
Yeah, Victoria,
Yeah.
no way. Oh, wow, that's amazing. 10 degrees Celsius is lovely, man. You're crazy. Clearly, you didn't grow up in the prairies of Canada. I
Sorry,
didn't.
did I meant minus 10. Sorry. Did I say 10?
You fucking said 10
Sorry,
degrees.
Iceland just flipped now. Sorry, because there's fucking snow, right? There's fucking
Okay, well, I
snow.
knew that. Okay, dude. Yeah, I just thought you meant specifically your.
Sorry, minus 10 degrees Celsius. I don't know how much.
Well, that's a 20 degrees Celsius difference, a pretty big fucking difference in temperature.
Yeah.
But that's, I thought you meant specifically Rachel because it's right on the water. I'm like, wow, it's like in Vancouver or something. Crazy. But it's 2 degrees Celsius in Iceland at this moment. And what is it here at this very moment? Oh, fuck, come on, Northern. Are you kidding me? It feels like minus 4. It's 1 degree here, right now, 1 degree.
So it's actually warmer in Iceland than it is in Toronto right now. So you know, don't think Iceland is like minus like 50 Celsius, like
200,000 people in the greater Reykjavik area. So that's right. It's like a Regina, Saskatchewan, which is where I spent my childhood. Mm-hmm. So there's a nostalgia. It's a good city size.
It's a good country size, because like you're talking about, there's big sways in politics and ridiculousness can be taken care of, and not a lot of resistance. And you know, honestly, when you live in a place where there's 200,000 people, you're more concerned about your reputation. You're less anonymous, right? Like, it's like in Toronto, it's like, I'm never going to see that guy ever fucking again.
Dude, everyone you ever see in every restaurant, you're never going to fucking ever see again.
Ever. Yeah. But in fact, you know, but in Iceland, it's like there's social cohesion because you're my neighbor and everyone's my neighbor. And
yeah. You're an artisan, I'm an alphasin.
Yeah.
And we're going to see each other again, man.
Yeah.
Pure Icelandage. We may or may not go to Iceland for a movie, right?
Mm-hmm.
Shoot some Iceland there. House Hunt.
I want to. I honestly, I want to go back. I do want to go back.
Yes, yeah.
It has a special place in my heart. This, but yeah, like, yeah, it's a great place. A lot of stories I can tell about that. Mm-hmm. And the best lime I've ever had in my life was at one of the restaurants. There.
Lime.
Lamb.
Oh, lamb.
The Northern Lights Inn. Oh, yeah. Insane.
That's lamb. Okay.
I asked to talk to the chef, and she came out. She's like, "Oh, you like my sauce?" I was like, "Yes." Is there truffle oil? What are you doing here? She's like, "Oh, it's my secret." And I was like, "I respect that. You're a chef."
You're an artist.
Like, you came out to talk to me. Like, you're an artist. You're a chef. You don't have to tell me your recipe, even though I really want to fucking know.
But just don't blow your nose in public in Iceland, right?
Oh yeah, yeah. In Iceland, they don't blow their nose in public.
That would be like picking your nose or farting or something. It's something you go to the bathroom and take
out. Yeah, it would be like letting out a huge fart in the middle of a restaurant, not thinking anything of it. It's like, oh, Americans. Oh, gross.
Kleenex.
Honestly, like, we're not joking. In Iceland, you go to the bathroom to blow your nose. You do not do that in public. And it's...
Yeah. But if you're blowing a cock.
Blowing a cock, yeah.
I can do that. Well, that's only natural, man. When the cock starts getting blown, next thing you know, cock's everywhere getting blown.
It's like an Icelandic orgy.
It is. It's just spontaneous, man. All it takes is the first cock.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know what else we can talk about. But, I don't want to go into too much Iceland.
Yeah.
We get back to gaming.
Yeah. Dude, Norwegians are amazing. Every Norwegian girl I've ever looked at, my heart just broke. I don't think I could ever move there.
Hey, Joel's here. Oh, look at that. Might have some Joel invitation to the stream going on. How are we going to do this with sound? Because,
oh, shit, son, that's right.
Unless I Skype him on this PC, too. Or we just put like...
Yeah, yeah. That's exactly what we do. Do you have a headset?
Well, right here. I didn't bring one. But
because...
I have my like earbuds.
Sweet.
Earbud it?
Yeah. Joel is... How many Gold Iron Noob shirts are left? Tony, elitist man, you've been asking that so many times, man. It's, just five more times. Ask me five more times and I'll answer you. Just five more times, Tony. The next Dota 2 announcer pack announcement will be a link to it on the store. So just gotta wait for that. Gonna come with a dire tie, man. Dire tie, Jeremy. All right.
Getting ready to talk to Joel.
Did you hear about what happened with the dire tie with Dota 2? You know what that is, dire tie? If I say that.
I thought dire was one of the teams. What's the deal with that?
It is, yeah. But so Diretide was their harrowing event. You know, the league has the harrowing every year, and then they put out Halloween skins and stuff, really creepy stuff.
Which
ends tonight, by the way. So if you haven't bought your harrowing skins, man, did you buy any fucking skins?
No. What, are there any harrowing skins for the people?
Well, Pumpkinhead Fiddlesticks, you're going to just let that go? You're never going to own that? How do you let Pumpkinhead Fiddlesticks? Where's Fiddlesticks bought, actually? Did that motherfucker... Dude, if that guy didn't get Pumpkinhead Fiddlesticks, then there's a problem in the universe. But, yeah, Diretide, so what happened was they didn't have their harrowing this year. And Valve went totally silent. The community was like, where's Diretide? Our league's getting harrowing. Where's our Diretide? And then it just didn't happen, and Valve totally went silent on it, which is really bad on their part.
What the hell?
And then, what's the matter?
I'm just looking for the plugin for...
I don't know what it is. It's fun. It's one of the sides. There's only the two sides. But anyway, yeah. People fucking lost their shit. Like, completely lost their shit. Like,
because they want to spend money.
Dude,
buying.
The Dota community went full retard. Like, Oscar, not even Oscar winning, like, two retard. And,
yeah.
And they started spamming, like, everywhere. And it made, like, news and all these blogs. And then just, like, a few days ago, Val's like, okay, we're going to do our Diretide, like, it's coming,
like, last minute. Like,
so, November, when there's, like, Christmas fucking marketing all over the place now in North America, they're going to put out the Diretide, which just seems, like, weird.
How the hell could they leave so much money on the table? Like,
you know you've got a lot of money on your fucking table when you don't see that big pile over there and you're leaving it on the table, you know? I guess the problem is they have too much fucking money. Like, they don't even... There's no one at Val or a group of people out there are that concerned about getting that pile of money. Or something, I don't know.
Well, they need to hire more people.
Exactly. That's something about League, too. League almost missed it. League's harrowing started this year super late. It was like October 30th or 29th. And people on the boards were like, what the fuck? Is it coming? Like, League started freaking out. And they actually posted, like, well, you know, it'll be done when it's done. If it comes out in November, it comes out in November. But, you know, I don't know if that's a good answer to a Halloween event. If it comes out in November, it comes out in November. But,
wow. Seems like they shot the bet on that. That's too bad. No one even saw that coming, too. Like,
yeah, it's...
So, Jared, you got a lot of me in here.
Into what here?
Oh. Okay, and then you're going to need Skype.
Mm-hmm.
Which may or may not. Do you know your Skype password?
Well, I'll give it a shot.
Oh, shit.
Unless you want to add me as Stacy or something.
They probably just kicked me from there. No, no, just... I love you, Jared. I love you, Circle Mates. They spelled my name wrong. I love you anyway. Yeah, like, if you look at Volvo, there was some meme in the Dota 2 community involving Volvo, because, like, Val, Volvo, you know?
Uh-huh.
Change a couple of the vowels. And they ended up spamming Volvo, and then Volvo actually kind of got involved in their Twitter and Facebook. They, like, responded to the Diretide or whatever.
That's
their
awesome.
Social media guys. Yeah, yeah, that's pretty cool. Thoughts on Joel's movie, Jarett Geoff? I haven't seen Joel's movie yet. Motherfucker hasn't given me a beta copy. Hasn't given me any motherfucking thing.
Yeah, I read the script years ago, and it was really good. So I'm looking forward
to it. I'm pretty psyched to see it, man.
I am psyched to see it. I've seen some stills online on Facebook. And...
I do know the story. I read the script, but I'm really excited to see the finished product. There's a lot of really talented people that worked on it, too. And I'm stoked.
Awesome. Let's give Joel a call here.
What's up with Femme Fatale? I saw her. She stopped in the chat earlier tonight and said hi. And then she was gone, and we were mid-story. She's back in school full-time. She's, like, responsible university student, like you all should be, unless you're done university. And yeah, school started, and now she's super, super busy. We kind of miss her, though, and we could really use someone else to help out.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, really miss having an intern. So,
Who likes editing videos from
does
the stream?
Does anybody like editing videos?
Who wants to cut stream highlights?
Stream highlights, everybody.
You'll never be a Dara, but you can be great. You can be great.
All right, get Joel on here.
Circlemates just subscribed. I love this guy. This guy's amazing. Boom! Oh my god. If Joel was here, I'd make him say boom headshot for you. I'm drinking the most disgusting concoction. I'm embarrassed to say what's in here, but it's...
Is that iced tea?
No. You know what it is? It's 80% club soda, water, zero calorie. And then it's a splash of orange juice and a splash of Coca-Cola, which gives it that nice diarrhea-looking texture, man.
Why do you put Coke in there with orange juice?
A splash of Coke just adds this candy flavor to it. The orange is Coke? No, it's close to like a Roy Rogers something, but it's missing the grenadine. It's missing something.
Interesting.
But it's actually super low calorie. It's just a splash. It's almost all water.
But it's tasty,
eh? Oh, it's tasty, man.
It's great.
It's great, man.
But it just looks like diarrhea.
It looks terrible. And that's why this drink would never take off. Look at that. We've all been there before. We've all had Chinese food before. And the next... we've all... seen something like that.
So, Joel.
So, are you all hooked up there, Cam? I'm gonna try to start a call here. Now you're gonna have to bear with me because we are an open broadcaster, so I'm a little bit newbie. Still, might be hiccupy. Switch that. And I'm gonna call him here. Oh, hey, dude. How's it going, sexy? Hold on, let me see if I can get you on the screen here. Oh, wow, that was easier than I thought. That worked out pretty well. Holy shit, I'm going to resize your face. That's pretty cool. Does that
big
work?
Joel face.
Oh. There we go. Okay. I got to keep this over here. No, that's not what I do. Okay. Oh my god, what's happening in the universe? Oh my god. You can't hear him? Lots of trolls. You probably look. Okay.
Well, Joel should be coming through this, right?
Joel is coming through this. All of your outputs maxed. Oh, geez.
You've got to import the audio from the Skype as well, right?
I don't.
Or there's some global audio setting that imports the audio as output from your speakers.
Oh, maybe here. Joel, try talking now.
See, I think we should be seeing a level on this monitor here. So I think you should go into your, see that? You should be seeing that there. So I think you've got to go into
Hold on just one second. Do you guys hear him at all or not at all? You can hear a little bit. Well, that's all I can do to this. And where else is it coming from? This Skype is purely.
So if game sounds, can you try playing an MP3?
Oh man, I'll play. See if it. Can we look at the levels on the output? Max it out.
Can you guys hear that song on the chat? Do you hear a song on the chat? We need information from the chat right now. No, so there's no song at all coming from the chat.
What? They don't hear that? All right, that's a shame. Well, wow. Only through his headset. All right.
Try settings. It's got to be something in open broadcast. General audio. So there you go. So go to desktop audio.
Put Dude, here. Yeah, speakers, I bet.
The output.
Here, I'll try this. I'll try this.
That should fix it.
Joel?
Can you hear that? Do we have to reboot maybe?
Are you louder?
Try the MP3 and then we'll try the speakers. Any check the monitor on the OBS?
Nothing.
Okay, try that other setting then.
Oh, that's the same.
Settings, desktop. So it will be applied next time you start streaming.
His microphone's up here. I can hear him fine. But
Jarett, the change is only applied next time you start streaming.
That's why. Okay. So it looks like the change is only applied if we start and stop streaming.
So we're going to have to nuke the stream, and then we'll come back.
Yeah, we're going to nuke it and come right back. And just to be 100% clear, you can't hear any music right now, right? Find a way to turn that off only because of copyright reasons, but you should buy that album if you haven't yet.
You recommended that much, yeah?
I bought it. I actually purchased it with my money. Not too much music that I purchase that I like so much. I'm like, that's worth $12, man.
There was a great song on last night's episode of Walking Dead. By Ben Howard. I don't know if you ever heard of Ben Howard.
Negative.
Check out Ben Howard, Oats in the Water.
Why are you so big? I'm so little here. I want to change that shit. There this I go, man. How do you like that? Fucker.
Hey, so,
that's better, Joel. There, that's right there. And we'll give Joel, we'll give him one eyeball. Here's one. Oh, is he
there?
Fuck.
Yeah, I guess. Okay, we'll meet you guys. Yeah, he's going to.
What?
Okay, can you call me in Skype?
No, I'm not calling you in Skype. Wait, you're right here, man. You're supposed to sit right here. But I can't listen. I can't hear Joel.
Oh, that's
you can't hear.
Call me on Skype, man.
Call me on Skype, man. Shit. All right. How do I add?
Unless we want to like share a headphone,
is it this big plus button?
Then we're pretty close to shaving our chests.
I'm gonna hold on a sec. Let me just
go to the Skype friends list and then add me to conversation.
Add people to this call. It's right here.
There you go.
I just didn't want to show my call list. It's
oh nice.
Perfect.
That craziness.
Awesome. I hear Joel now. What's going on?
Now this shit's all gonna be all messed up, man.
Yeah, that's definitely all messed up now.
Disgusting. I had it so nice, man. I had it so nice, and now... Why is this?
No, I got an echo of somebody saying shit.
No.
Well, it's probably your voice going through there and through this mic. So I got to mute my mic.
Yeah.
so then that's probably better. I don't know.
Why is this halted? Why is Joel halted?
I'm halted.
Is he? Yeah, I don't see you moving on the stream.
I'm not moving on the stream. Yeah, I'm definitely moving on.
You're definitely moving on Skype. Why? I don't understand this at all, man. Why did this stop working? What?
I just tried to share my video and it fucked up.
I. What the fuck? I'm gonna call you back, Joel.
Boom.
This is all fucked up.
So what's going on?
I don't know. I'm gonna try to call Joel here. Get Joel back on this motherfucker.
Mm-hmm. Hey, I'm back. Shit.
Video. Bang, dude.
Yeah, but as soon as I get added on Skype, video's good.
I lose the video and then you can't hear.
Yeah. So we'll switch heads.
So how about I go. Just to make sure there's not big hunks of earwax.
No, there's like echoes going everywhere.
Ew. And what we'll do is we'll do like junior high style when someone had a bad song. Like,
this song's great! Dude, listen to this song! Maybe awesome!
We don't give a fuck about eating and checking out
to the rodeo.
Oh, so he's swearing! It's not on my left, not on my right. Alright.
Piss me off.
You fucking jerk. Remember that song, Joel?
Nerves.
What song?
Do you remember that song? I don't know what it was called. It was like a rodeo song, and then the guy swore a bunch. You know, here comes
rodeo.
Second his hand, he's a bum bum man. He's off to the rodeo. And then it was like when we were like 10, it was so amazing that an adult was swearing like this in a song. It went viral in our elementary school culture, and then everyone walked around with their Walkman, like back when it was like physical like tape media, and then everyone like would do what Geoff and I are doing right now, so like two people could listen at the same time.
Oh my god.
It's like, oh, did he just say fuck? Whoa.
And it's like the shittiest music. It's like fucking Do Re Mi, like
Cale. And it's funny, like I imagine elementary schools now, like 2013, and some guy's like pulls out his smartphone. He's like, dude, did you see this chick shitting in this guy's mouth? And he's like, dude, yeah, obviously I fucking saw that. Jesus fuck, man. I've shat in girls' mouths, dude. I'm fucking 10.
Yeah, basically.
Like that's how I see modern youth culture.
Well, you never fucked one of your mom's buds? You've never fucked one of your mom's bud?
Yeah.
Dude, honestly, we had a buddy who will go unnamed who literally all three of us knew this guy that was surprised that we – at what? How old were we? 15?
Dude, I was like 14, 13.
And he was like, you've never – done one of your bud's moms? Like, come on, dude. You've never done one of your bud's moms?
Bullshit, not one. Not one of your friends.
Not even one.
He's a very alpha jockey guy, and I guess he'd had a number of his friends' moms, and he couldn't believe that we hadn't done that.
No one else had done that. Had to have been a common thing.
Hey man, I'm not judging, but wasn't my culture. Yeah. You know, some guys are out there doing Bud's moms, and some of us are out there playing Dragon Quest. Man, these fucking.
Like, you never complete Dragon Quest, man. Not even one Dragon Quest.
Yeah, not even one. Like, not even the first one. No.
Doing Bud's moms.
Yeah, doing Bud's moms. So yeah, we got your stream pimped up today. Didn't we do that?
Dude, I seem drunk this time. At least I don't seem high.
And Joel's eyes are wide open.
That's what I mean. He's smiling. He's thinking about all the Bud's mums he's done in the past.
Bud's mums, yeah.
I didn't do Bud's mums until I was 16.
So Joel's got some streaming potential, don't you, Joel? Streaming potential, don't you?
Yeah, potential. Not sure if it's gonna happen tonight or not. Depending on what time we finish up here. But yeah, it was looking good. We did a test today.
I'm not saying tonight you're gonna be streaming. I'm just saying.
Oh, you're streaming right now.
You are technically streaming right now. But what I
think is
Joel Gardner's perspective. From his basement 4,000 kilometers away from us. Well, right? True that. People keep asking us what our thoughts on COD Ghosts are. Well, I don't have it. I haven't played it yet.
I don't even have any thoughts on it, man. I'm passing on this season's my yearly subscription. I'm passing on. And I have no regrets so far. It's just more maps with slightly tweaked, you know. Do I need to pay $60 for a slightly tweaked version of a game I'm already playing?
And enjoying, right?
And enjoying. I'm still enjoying it. Although,
were you like, man, this game sucks. I need something almost identical. Grand
Theft Auto.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, man. And especially right now because of the new console cycle coming up, the new console generation. There's so many FPSs, like they're like sort of launch titles, all like the Titanfalls, the Destinies coming, all that stuff. That it's actually like, as far as this time of year goes, like there's way more on the horizon that's original and slightly different in this world of almost exactly the same games every year. So, like Destiny, I'm actually, it's the only one that I was kind of interested in playing. Titanfall I wrote off because it's an Xbox One exclusive and it's not on my radar. I don't know when I'll get an Xbox One, if ever, but it's not, like, certainly not the launch season or launch window. But Destiny seems like might be cool. I don't know. I heard they're trying to push, like, some really, you know, forward-thinking stuff, like having an Android app that accompanies the game that keeps you like persistently sort of involved in what's happening or whatever. And, you know, there's like a lot of things that I think that more and more all games will do, you know, 10 years from now. Because did I just pull that out of here?
Yeah. We got to figure out some way to get this elbow situation.
But you know, think about, like, how many gamers, like, how many people in the chat now, how many gamers in the world that have an Xbox or a PlayStation of any of the varieties or a PC or anything and don't have a smartphone? Like, I think it's 0.something%. So it just makes sense to have complementary apps for those devices, free apps that enhance the experience around the app and that can keep you connected 24 hours a day. So even when you're at school, you can check in on your guy or you can check in on the world and that kind of thing. And it sort of keeps you integrated 24/7. And I know Destiny was teasing at having that kind of stuff. And I've been waiting for games for every game to go that far. So, and it's like the Halo guys that made Call of Duty. Like there's obviously some pretty creative talent behind the people there. So I don't know. We'll see.
But yeah, to be honest, I haven't heard much of Destiny. You know, I've all heard that the next best or big FPS is going to be Titanfall. This is gonna actually change the gameplay somehow, adding all these mechs and shit like that. To be honest, I don't know. I'll check it out on PC. Definitely won't be getting it on Xbox One.
It's on PC, but it's not on PS4, right?
No, it's not PS4.
But it's PC.
PC and Xbox, yeah.
I don't see
how... I shouldn't say it's Xbox One exclusive. Like, it'll also be on the 360, but...
I don't really see how adding mechs changes the whole... You're running around with some WASD pointing and shooting shit. Like, what the fuck? If you're,
what are you gonna do? Yeah. You know,
how do you reinvent the genre? But anyways, yeah.
They need to stop just thinking of new games to put in that genre. They have to start thinking of new fucking genres, man.
That's what MOBA was. Like, there was no such thing as a MOBA. It's a brand new genre. Now it's the most played game on planet Earth. It's a game from a new genre that didn't exist 5 fucking years ago. And I think there's a lot of potential for those types of new genres. Although right now in the mobile space, and now even in the PC space, card games are just huge. Like, the number one mobile game in China is a card game. You're getting all the nice, like, gambling elements of buying card packs that might get you something cool. And people are so addicted to that. And,
Well, just the aspect of cards, there's something there. Like a card means gambling to a lot of people.
Yeah, it's no surprise Blizzard's making Hearthstone. And it's no surprise either that, I don't know if you guys saw this, but Riot Games had their extra game leaked, their new game.
Ooh. Riot Games is now worthy of the S at the end of the
day. Well, except that apparently it's a canceled game. And by the looks of the art, I'm like, I hope it's fucking canceled, because it looked like pretty amateurish. It looked like League Season 1 kind of borders and backgrounds and art and stuff. And you're like, it looked like an indie project. I can't remember what the fuck it was called. But it was a card game. No shit. They were like making a League of Legends card game.
Maybe.
Can someone please put what it's called? I think it started with an S. It's driving me crazy. It wasn't Summoners.
Wait.
The fuck was it? And someone in chat's got to know what it was called. Anyways, yeah. So even they were working on a card game. Because, dude, like, these mobile games, like Clash of Clans and these card games, like, they make billions. Like, a ridiculous, ridiculous, ridiculous amount of money.
Yeah,
so much more.
Those games, you know, those are just time wasters. Like, we talked about this before, like Candy Crush. Like, that's not a fucking game, dude. Like, none of those are really games. Those are just fucking time wasters. Like, I'm playing Pixel People right now on my iPhone, and I'll sit there for fucking 20 minutes before I realize, like, holy shit, I gotta stop playing this thing because it's so addictive. But there's no point to it, and it's not hard. It's just I'm pressing buttons, just pressing my thing.
Well, it's a good thing that I knew you were playing it, because it made sure to keep me updated on Facebook. I appreciate that.
What? What is this? What are you talking about?
I fucking emailed you because I was like, this is awkward.
Candy Crush. You're talking about
Candy Crush. Is that what you were talking about? I was like, this is like you're on a first date and the girl's got food in her teeth. You're like, fuck. should I email Joel? Like, does he know that my Facebook feed has his Candy Crush at all?
I don't know how to get rid of that shit now. Like, I still get no. I don't play that fucking crack anymore. But
it's clearly crack. The game made billions of dollars, man.
Dude, the revenue it is like millions of dollars a day. They fucking wrap it.
So what are the addictive elements of Candy Crush? Like, is it just like this game plays amazing, or isn't it just like aligning shapes and shit? Like, is there
progression?
It's just matching three different candies in a row, and if you do like an L shape or whatever, you'll get a special power. But it's the sounds, it's the sights, and it's just the.
It's
not really even a reward to it. The only reward is to get to the next level. But even that, it's one of those games where it's free to play and it's super easy until you get to a point where you can no longer pass unless you buy some power-ups and shit.
What an amazing business is all I have to say. Like honestly, it's kind of like that episode of Star Trek: The Next Generation where everyone plays the game and it's addictive.
Yeah.
Gets in your brain. Like, Wesley Crusher is the only one who's not in. And what's her name? Was the guest star. Judd, one of the... Anyway, I can't remember. Some big star was a guest star. I have to play this and hear the sounds, because it's like, if these sounds are amazing, I have to put that sound design into any game or movie or TV I work on. Like, wow. That's pretty crazy. Like,
it's probably not the sounds, but
it's not Denise Crosby. It was
one of the Judds?
Maybe. Not Judd Apatow. That's the wrong Judd, buddy. It was like Charlize Theron, maybe? I can't remember. It was like someone like her. Someone's got to Google it. And my ear doesn't extend that far, so I can't. But... Here it is.
It had to have been Ashley Judd.
People can't hear it, but it's on the show. Just...
Well, it's 40 below, and I don't give a fuck. Got a heater in my truck, and I'm off to the rodeo. In a town, I'm on a left and out, I'm on a right. Come on, you fucking let me get your right, step right. Get off stage, goddamn good, you know. You piss me off, you fucking jerk. You get on my nerves.
Shit.
Well, here comes Johnny with his pecker in his hand. He's a one ball man, and he's off to the rodeo.
Yeah, so that's that went viral in my in my elementary school, grade five.
Really, it's called the rodeo song.
Yeah, the rodeo song.
The rodeo
and it was
song.
Called Chris Ledoux, and I want to thank Kay Woodridge for tweeting me that, because I never did know whoever made that. Today I learned Chris Ledoux, some French dude somewhere, made the rodeo song, and here, let me link it in chat.
That was the best shit, the most viral shit in like 1989.
So viral. Oh, it was crazy viral, man.
And
yeah, there you go, guys. You can listen to it to your heart's content. I linked it there in chat.
And it's, I'll have to listen to this later.
Mm-hmm. Doesn't get much better. How did that guy find that already, man?
We sang a bunch of lyrics and Google.
It's true. That's true. It's true. Our deep knowledge of the lyrics.
Mm-hmm. That will be forever. And the most important part of our brain, mm-hmm. of all those things we could store mm-hmm. in our brains, is that great. Stupid, stupid fucking song.
Yeah. It's amazing.
It's like... yeah.
It's funny.
Yo, I had a request. My buddy built an iOS app that was featured on the front page today and is listening right now. Could you give him a shout-out? His name is Mike Stevens.
Mike Stevens.
Mike Stevens. Shout-out to you, Mike Stevens.
Mike Stevens.
Mike Stevens, Mike Stevens. You rocked the App Store.
My next-door neighbor when I was little, he was named Mike Stevens. The only black guy in the neighborhood.
Mike Stevens. Mike Stevens. Everyone give it to Mike Stevens.
Is this in Parkland?
Yeah, this is in Parkland, man.
Nice.
Actually, the guy's name is Mark Patton. I just wanted to troll a little bit.
Yeah,
Mark Patton. Congrats, Mark.
Hey, so Denoli, I think graduated recently from school.
Yes.
Video game development. We should give him a shout out for that. You know, speak to
Denoli
3.
Everyone in the chat, I just assume knows who Denoli 3 is. I mean, come on, it's freaking Denoli 3.
Yeah, if you don't, you're a pure much noob.
But Denoli 3. But...
And no, I'm not getting a PS4 or an Xbox One day one. I do not see the point whatsoever. Somebody's asking.
I only pre-ordered a PS4. I did it back in literally during E3 or whenever the day they went online to pre-order, I ordered one because I was up in the hype. It was more of like a fuck you to Microsoft when I did it because I never even owned a PS3. I had a PS1 and a PS2, and then I went Xbox 360 for the last gen. And I've always had every Nintendo system. That's a given. They're like Nintendo's in its own category. But this time I was in complete shock after E3. The fucking balls on Microsoft with the DRM and with their attitude, and then the interviews the execs were giving this cocky, arrogant douchebag.
Like, are you on the development team?
Yeah.
Like, do you know what's best for the development team?
And like, it was like. It was so clear I can't support a product that has those douchebags working on it. And that guy has since has left and gone to another company.
Well, he got fired, yeah. Of course, he got
probably
fired.
He's an idiot
if that's the way he talks to the press.
This shitty last night's Chinese food was coming out of his mouth.
Yeah.
I'm like, this guy needs to lose his job right now. He needs to lose something.
Oh, it's like somebody, Microsoft made a good decision. I have more faith than Microsoft.
And some other fucking idiots hired the guy, I'm sure, right away for six figures to be an idiot at their fucking company because of his resume, which proves somehow that he's not an idiot. And if you're an idiot and you don't know what a non-idiot looks like, all you have to go on is a resume.
Mm-hmm.
If you can't intuitively understand what an idiot looks like when you look at interviews like that. Don Major, is that his name? Anyway, he's out there fucking some other shit up right now for some other company, and these shareholders will never understand why.
Well, he might be good at his job, you know. If he doesn't understand what he did wrong in that situation with Microsoft, he shouldn't talk to the press. He shouldn't talk to the public. And there's a lot of people that never talk to the public that do well in their jobs. And you know, but it's like if you don't understand why that was a simple, stupid mistake. Like, it's, come on, you don't ever, like, talk that way. There's a million other ways to spin that conversation into something that works.
Yeah, but Zynga hired him.
That
booming entity.
Mm-hmm.
Zynga. Now people come and go, but yeah, I don't know what to do with my PS4. It's coming on Friday. I pre-ordered it months and months and months ago on an emotional whim, and I think I should hawk it for cash because I kind of want one new console, either the Xbox One or PS4, like a year from now, but like, what's the point in sitting on it? Like, I got the Wii U because I'm just a Nintendo irrational fanboy, and so I buy everything day one that Nintendo makes, and it literally just went unused. Like, it literally sat in my living room and got, like, once every 2 months someone, like, booted up me to update the firmware to satisfy some weird thing.
It's quite an experience to buy a console and then just never use it.
Yeah,
right? Because you have your games on your PC, and you're like
well, we used it a little bit for here and there, but what's really funny is that I started using it and I'm playing all my Wii shit on it. My virtual console titles and stuff I ported over, and Wii Fit and all the shit that I was playing. Like, I started playing literally my Wii games on it, is why we're bringing it up. At this point, it's actually a Netflix machine. And I appreciate that it can do Netflix at 1080p. That was the biggest upgrade to my life, I think.
There you go, yeah. Might as well 1080p that shit when you're paying for it.
Hey, man, whopping $7.99 a month. I'm a paid media consumer now.
Oh, is somebody subscribe?
Yes.
There's a couple of people subscribe.
Yes, there's.
Oh, nice.
The people with stars beside their name.
Subs.
Dude, subs. As soon as we have a few subs, we're going to start just having sub wars.
Sub
wars.
Yeah, sub wars where we just take our subs, put them in a game, and kick the fuck out of them for a while.
Look at this. Look at the subs commenting there. There you go.
Triple sub in a row. Oh my god, that's amazing.
Jarett, do you think it's ironic that, like, the star is used for subs as an icon? You got a star on your chest? On your belly?
Yes, that's very true.
It's cooler to unsub.
I'm subbing right now. I love Yeah, I had that Halloween costume.
Oh yeah, you did were Mr. McMean.
I was Sylvester McMonkey McBean for Halloween, and I put my picture on Facebook, and I had more likes on that photo than anything I've ever put on Facebook. I don't really use Facebook very much, or I don't have like I've only mostly got like real life friends on Facebook, but it was something like 40% of people that are my friends like that photo. Like, it was a creepy experience for me, actually, because I didn't realize anyone even looked at anything I ever put on Facebook, and then that fucking picture for some reason just exploded. Really weird. I would drop it in here, but I'm on OBS and I don't even know. Hold on, if I do this, hold on, can we still see Joel is the question. So I'll keep going.
Can you still see me? He looks like it.
No. I gotta keep that open. Then we can see it, right? Oh. No, Joel, come back to me. Okay. Hand wave. There we go. It's the gayest hand wave. All right.
I just saw your hand wave.
It's a pretty big delay.
Yeah.
Hippie Hacker just subscribed. All right, Hippie Hacker. Woo.
Oh, yeah, that's what I was going to do. I was going to try to add this photo. There's no really simple way to do it. But if I add this and go browse and then...
You know, we're talking about like PS4 and shit like that, dude. It's funny, like all these, the next gen coming out. But you know what the game I'm most excited about that's coming out in the next few months?
What's that?
Is the new Mario, dude. Is the fucking Wii U title. Dude. It's like, it's not on PS4, Xbox One. It's fucking.
It looks
the
amazing.
Next Mario, dude. It looks so fucking awesome.
Yeah. I know. I don't want to bring it up because I'm always a Nintendo's dick, but. I mean, really, it looks like it's not just Mario, it's the Zelda 2, but it looks like they finally sort of pushed it forward a little bit. And it, aesthetically, like the environment, the characters, the way that it's played, it seems like the first one since Super Mario 64 on the Nintendo 64 that's just perfect in all respects. Like, yeah. They hit everything, it's just perfect. It's not like, oh, we've gone back to the side-scroller style, and it's like, oh, it's harkening the old past, cool, or, oh, we're going, like, really far forward, and like, the whole game's going to be on small spheres that make you dizzy running around them, like Super Mario Galaxy, which I played through, but I never bought the second one. Like, you know, the first one was kind of fun, like, I felt...
You don't want more of it. It's like,
I did want more of it.
Galaxy, eh?
I mean, I enjoyed it for a while, but after a while, I'm not sure if it made me dizzy and in an odd way claustrophobic, even though I'm in space, but like I felt so trapped moving from these spheres that I was like, man, how come? This is around Super Mario Galaxy, after I finished the game, I was like, you know, it was cool, but how come they never made another Super Mario 64? And the closest they came was Sunshine, right? Super Mario 64.
Isn't it the same guys that did Galaxy?
I don't know. I don't even know who's on the team anymore. Yeah, all I know is that they made Super Mario Galaxy, which had the same playstyle as Super Mario 64, but then it lacked all the diversity. It was like, the whole game's on a beach. It's like, it's all beach, water, beach, water, yeah. But I'm like, no, man, a Mario game has water levels, it has ice levels, you know, it has the full spectrum. And so the new one coming out, Super Mario 3D World, or whatever it's called, it just seems like such a perfect blend of all the Mario aesthetic and then some innovation on top that's actually like a really good step forward in terms of where they could go. And then the new Zelda coming out, A Link to the Worlds, it's getting the same kind of reviews. It's like finally they've evolved Zelda, made it different than the stale usual Zelda. They kept all the magic. Great world, bright, not Twilight Princess, dark, like brooding Zelda, but no, bright, open world Zelda. And then, I don't know if you noticed, but like now in the new Zelda, like it's not so linear in terms of you do this dungeon, you get this item that allows you to go to this dungeon and do it now, because now you have your hookshot. And then you get your hookshot, you can go there and get your bow. And the bow, you actually have this dude at the beginning that rents you any item, but you can, I think, you know, don't quote me, but I think you can have like only one at a time. So it's like, hey, you pay money and you rent the hookshot. Now you can roam the world and find places where that benefits you and find the dungeon you can do with that. So basically, like, you know, sure, each dungeon still requires you to have a certain set of tools to be able to complete it, but now it's more open world. You can do them in any order you want. There's no order to the dungeons. You just, whatever weapon you decide to go with, and you go do the dungeon kind of thing. So they changed up little bits like that, but it looks really, really, really cool.
I haven't seen anything about the new Zelda, but the new Mario looks pretty sick.
Yeah, the Mario looks sick too. I'm really excited for it. I have them both on pre-order. I don't pre-order much, but I get so giddy. What am I looking for?
What are you looking for? Oh, yours.
This is Halloween. But I don't know. Oh, there we go. This photo.
How was the full body costume? I didn't ever see that.
It was really just some jeans. Some jeans.
Where did you get a yellow shirt from?
Stace found me a yellow shirt at some store or something. Yeah.
Very cool.
Yeah, it was pretty neat. Anyway, it was very obscure. Too, you know, people like, oh, are you like just a leprechaun? It's like, no, actually, it's a story. Well, what made it extra cool actually is that, well, the The costume was a little bit inspired by my son, because the Sneetches is his favorite Dr. Seuss story, and so he wanted to be a Sneetch for Halloween. And so him and Stacy both went as Sneetches as one of their costumes, and I was Sylvester McMucky McBean, who's a key character in the story. And so we kind of went as a family theme again. Last year it was Nintendo theme. This year it was Dr. Seuss themed, which I think we'll keep up, actually. I'm really digging Dr. Seuss. I already got ideas for next year's family.
Plenty of characters.
Plenty of characters, man. Yeah, pretty cool. Dude, if you have a 3DS XL, you've got to get Mario Man. Come on. You got a man. What were you as Halloween this year?
I was lame.
You were lame?
It was a pun costume. It was suggested by my wife, Allison.
Oh yeah, pin it on Allison. All right.
Well, she's a big pun fan, so she mentioned Geoff Leppard.
Geoff Leppard
as the band. So I went as Geoff Leppard. It's a pun on the band, and I was just like, okay.
So did you have one arm and some leotards?
Well, no, I had leopard skin and a name tag spelled Geff, and rock stuff, and that was it. But you know, I didn't sever my arm or hide my arm, because you know, I'm about practicality with the costume. I'm like, whatever, it's a costume. People think you're lame. If you show up as nothing, they think you're lame. If you show up as the bare minimum effort, they're like, okay, you're not interesting, but let's get on with the party. So anyway, I really should spend more time on my costumes, because a lot of people do, and it's fun. And,
yeah.
But I'm so lazy when it comes to Halloween costumes, because it's one fucking night and then it's over in 5 seconds, and then it's like, okay, so let's just keep going with our lives. And it's like, it's literally a 5 second costume. And I'm just like, if I spend like a day on this, I just feel like I got a lot of shit to do. I got a lot of like creative things to make, and like you know, my Halloween costume that, you know, and also for actors, for you guys, like Patrick Stewart was on, I can't remember what talk show, but he was saying that, like, you know, he didn't want to dress up at Halloween because, like, he dresses up for a living. He puts on a costume in his day job. It's like, fuck. It's like, do you want to, like, cash out some customers at, like, Safeway for, like, Halloween? Like, huh, it'll be fun. It's like, no, that's my fucking job, man. Like, you know, so he didn't want to do it. But then his girlfriend, now wife, I think, who's, like, 39 years old or whatever, bought him a lobster costume, and Patrick Stewart tweeted himself
in the bathtub
as a lobster. I'm sure we've all seen that.
Oh, you follow,
which is hilarious, man. He's such a fun. He seems like a fun. I never met him, but he seems like a very fun man. Like, he's just.
Oh, what's going on? Coffee crisps were thrown on the floor.
He's just a happy man, you know. He just seems like a good, fun, talented motherfucker, and obviously the guy knows how to fucking act, and you know, seems pretty good at living his life too. So yeah, I respect him for that. And
you just go on that floor. Stacey's a fucking enabler, man.
It's a coffin crisp, not a coffee
this
crisp.
It's a coffin crisp. It's not sponsored by Coffin Crisp. This shit will kill you. But I'm gonna eat it anyway, because I can't help myself. You have to take a bite, you have to crunch, but don't put it in your mouth.
It's good.
That's the rough fucking round.
Do you guys have coffee crisp? Does this Well, this isn't the packaging.
So is it international?
It's typically it's a yellow packaging, bright yellow with red light.
No, I think coffee crisp is just Canadian, isn't it?
Really? Like, is coffee crisp in the U.S. or Europe? Never seen it in the U.S.
Yeah. I'm sure this fucking candy bar, man.
Remember, Dennis loves coffee crisp, man. Remember, he said he can't get it anywhere but Canada.
Really? I meant that Smarties. When I went to Australia, I brought them some Smarties, because I know they don't have Smarties. In the States, they don't have Smarties either. Well, they have a product called Smarties, but what it actually is that shit we sell here called Rockets that nobody fucking eats, but they don't have our Smarties, which is the best shit ever. Oh.
Oh, man. Yeah, there's a lot of great candy bars. Honestly, like, you go to the States, it's like Babe Ruth? Like, what the fuck is this? Like, Like they got some shit candy bars.
Shit candy bars. And like, to the packaging in their candy bars. It looks like it's from the 80s or the 70s. Like when I go there, like the they're using like just like tight new Roman font and this generic background. It's like I couldn't believe how shitty it looks. And when I came back to Canada, especially when I was there for like 6 months, I came back to Canada and just to walk into a, you know, your gas station, you see the chocolate bars. It feels like you're in the 22nd century, like you're in an Arnold Schwarzenegger film. All the packaging, like the super sleek futuristic font, the shiny packaging and everything. And I was like, oh shit, yeah, that's right. That's what packaging looks like.
Babe Ruth's are fine, says a man who has never had a coffee crisp. or crunchy. Man, crunchy, the sponge toffee, man.
Oh.
You've never had sponge well anyway, crunchy's my favorite, so I'm fine.
Crunchy's my favorite too, I think, man.
Crunchy is the best fucking candy bar, and it's not in the but isn't that amazing how it's all regional? Because you know, we share the same DNA basically. Like, you know, it's just regional marketing and habits and culture that
Fucking it's David Bacon says Eat More is the best fucking candy bar ever. You ever had Eat More, Joel?
Eat More is an acquired taste, dude.
Dude,
it's a sophisticated bar.
Eat More now. I don't eat candy bars anymore.
Dude, like, I thought it was so disgusting when I first tried it.
Dude,
but
yeah.
After, like, my fifth one, they're pretty fucking good,
dude,
man.
See, growing up, when back in the day when, you know, you'd save and get big candy bars from the store, I thought Eat More's were just disgusting. And my dad would always get Eat More's.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, they're
like,
old
man. Yeah, it's a fucking old man candy bar. It's like, so
yeah.
Disgusting.
Yeah.
And then you know, I'd have a piece of that, like a chewy chocolate goodness with the nuts. And then and all of a sudden one day I was at the store.
Your mouth.
And I was looking at the candy bars, I'm looking at Coffee Crisp, I'm looking at Kit Kat, man, I'm looking at all the shit I normally get, and I look over at fucking Eat More. And I walked out of the store with an Eat More bar on the way home. And it was like a weird mixture of like pleasure and guilt. Like I felt like I was doing something I shouldn't be doing.
dude, I haven't had an Eat More in so long.
Dude, it became
more?
My favorite chocolate bar for a period of like a couple years of my life where it's like, it was all about Eat More. It was like the best. And my friends would make fun of me. And I was like, dude, did you seriously just get an Eat More? Like, yeah, man. Fucking,
chocolate bar.
You just don't understand. Did you just.
Like,
everybody was getting Coffee Crisp. Coffee Crisp and Kit Kat, man. That was the shit, right? So.
You know, the thing with Coffee Crisp is, here's my take on it, is that the chocolate to crisp ratio of the full-size bar is a bit low. Therefore, I prefer the fun-size, smaller Halloween Coffee Crisp.
I absolutely do, man.
And it's because, you know, the surface area ratio is different, and it's a better mix of flavors. So I actually never buy full-size Coffee Crisp. I always buy the Halloween
small
ones. Yeah.
Yeah, and it's too much. Like, that little Coffee Crisp, we just had a little mini Coffee Crisp.
Yeah.
And already, it's like, I'm pretty overwhelmed with sweetness in my old age. Like, I wouldn't want to back that up with another bite or anything. It's like, I'm good for a few hours on that.
My blood sugar level is fine.
Yeah, I don't need to go into shock.
Oh, dude, I'm a chocolate fiend. I'll mow down like 20 of those, no problem.
Then you feel like weird.
You look it.
You're like, you're vibrating. But yeah, man, if you don't have gut issues, then go to town, motherfucker.
That's great.
Eat that shit.
Dude, when I see skinny people not eating bacon, I get mad. I'm like, you are wasting the most incredible opportunity. Are you fucking retarded? Like, my whole life is a constant.
Dude,
like,
we just discovered the best way to cook bacon now. Have you ever baked bacon?
Like in the oven on a tray.
Yeah.
For sure, man.
Oh,
it
yes,
is the best way.
Of course.
Fully
it's
agree.
Amazing now.
We just kind of discovered that. Like, just tin foil in a tray and put the bacon in there. Holy fuck, it's the best way.
Dude, I once ordered a product off television. It's the only product I've ever ordered off television. I'm not proud of it. Not
bacon
gonna,
wave?
I'm not going to deny it either. Yeah, I ordered the bacon wave. Was it the bacon wave 2000 or is it bacon wave?
I think it was just the bacon
just
wave.
Bacon. Ordered off TV. Not proud, not denying it. And it held your bacon sort of vertically. Upwards, and then you'd stack it along this plastic holder, and then you would microwave it, and I'd never had bacon like that before. I'm like, well, fuck, man, I'm a man of every kind of bacon. It's a part of who I am. Caught the bacon wave, and you know what, man, it was pretty fucking good.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty fucking good. I threw it in my regular routine. Sometimes you got to fry bacon. Sometimes you got to bake bacon. Sometimes you got to bacon wave bacon. And if you're really hurting for some bacon, you just got off work, man, it's 8 in the morning, you pulled the night shift, and you're like, I don't have time to cook up a pound of bacon. But by the time I finished loading EverQuest, the bacon weighs motherfucking done. And I got bacon and EverQuest, Budweiser's, some Export A's.
Nice.
Cigarettes. Those are days.
That was the life of complete, like, bad for you A, bad for you B, bad for you C.
Literally got on.
Bad for you D.
This is an EverQuest. University is Saturday nights. It's really funny. I work, so in university, I'm in the prime of my life. Every Saturday night from 11 p.m. to 7:30 a.m. I worked. So there was no going out on Saturday night. Everyone else would go out and party. I'd go to fucking work. But then when I got home, I felt entitled to do whatever the fuck I wanted. So leaving work, I'd get some fucking beef jerky and a chocolate bar. I'd eat that shit in the car on the way home. Fucking beef jerky, fucking chocolate bar. I'd get home, I'd crack a beer, I'd put some fucking bacon in the bacon wave, I'd light a cigarette, I'd sit down and play EverQuest.
And because of your like early 20s metabolism, you were thinner.
And I was thin.
You were
now. Oh, dude, I was like 145 pounds. Like,
now, so it's the time to do it.
Yeah, it's the time to do it. But it was just like from every angle, from the
fat
and the cholesterol and the tobacco and the beer, just like
destroy your body.
Well, what's funny is that the rest of my house, when you know it's like a university house, it's like 6 of us there. They'd get up and like 2 hours later, it'd be like 10 in the morning. They'd be like, "What are you fucking doing?" Like, and they look at me like I'm a fucking drug addict. Because they get that, and I'm playing fucking EverQuest, I got bacon, I got fucking beer, I got fucking cigarettes.
I'm like, dude, this is my like 7 p.m. Friday.
Dude, I'm like, yeah, I just got fucking work. You leave me alone. But those were the days, man.
Oh, damn.
I regret the cigarettes a bit. Don't really regret the rest, man.
Yeah, bacon, fine. Cigarettes, can't really make a reason. I've never smoked them myself, but Jarett has, and I don't think he's ever like defended the experience or would repeat it.
No. I mean, obviously, there were benefits, but they never outweighed.
No, he used to defend the experience.
Anyone. No, I will defend the fact that there exist positives. It's not like a 100% negative experience. It's only that the negatives outweigh the positives. But people smoke for a reason, right? Kind of feels pretty fucking good sometimes when you're into that shit. You wouldn't know that, though, Joel.
I know nothing about that.
What does smoke feel like in my lungs? I don't know.
Warm, meditative goodness. And there were certain moments in life, like Paul Manis is saying, cigarettes after sex, cigarettes after beer. It was these things that for a while I couldn't imagine life without. It's like, yeah, I'll stop smoking cigarettes, except after I just came. Right? Obviously, you're talking about that. Unless I'm at the bar drinking beer, of course. Anyway, have not touched a cigarette in nine years. Just for the record, man.
9 years, right?
Yeah, 9 years. Hard to fucking believe. 9 years.
Yeah, it's that long ago.
Okay.
I was just thinking, like, you know, people gift you games in the middle of a stream, or they'll send you stuff,
yeah,
or they'll link things in chat. Imagine if you had the technology to beam shit around. Like, I think we'd have 3 Eat More bars right here, you know?
Yeah.
And we'd have a pack of cigarettes, we'd have beer, we'd have bacon wave bacon. Like, wouldn't that be great if you could just stream? And like,
you'll be able to do that shit, just print yourself up an Eat More bar.
Someone 3D prints us an Eat More bar, and we're like, oh, thanks, like, you know, like, blah, 32. Like, I'm going to stream for fucking ever eating Eat More bars. Like, wouldn't that be great?
Dude, when donations go beyond cash, when it's like they're donating physical product
that you're going to interact
with. Because I got a stream tonight, I'm super fucking hungry. Steak! You're like, oh, thanks, man. Thanks.
I would be eating a jalapeno burger, Geoff. You know what? I saw a billboard on the way here. You know the Tim Hortons breakfast sandwich?
I've had quite a few of them.
There's a new jalapeno.
Oh, shit.
Tim Hortons breakfast sandwich. It's fucking jalapeno muffin.
It sounds really good.
Man, I literally was on my way here on the streetcar, and I saw the billboard. I'm like, I'm having one tomorrow morning. that's where we're
eating. $1.89.
It's, yeah. It's
fucking nasty.
Is it? Is it nasty?
Because I think we know what's going to be nasty, though, right?
Yeah, well, we know it's going to be something. We know it's going to be what Tim Hortons food is. And it's like, you have, go in with that expectation, like, you know, it's, you know, I make a better breakfast sandwich at home, right? But you go in there and you get it now, and you get it for $1.89, and it just happens, and there it is in your hand, and it's okay. And I wouldn't bake, you know, it's fresher than the bread I use at home, right? Like, I wouldn't bake myself like 2 hours ago that bread. So there's an advantage there, right? But yeah, it's okay for $2 worth of food. It still boggles my mind that they can offer that. Like, I always think of like the price scares me. If it was $4, I'd probably enjoy it more.
Yeah.
I'd probably be like, this is some quality food right here, because it's $4.
It's probably an actual egg.
Yeah, exactly. But the fact that it's $2, I'm like, how the fuck do they, is that, man, laying an egg must cost $1.
Yeah,
like,
I find that, yeah, especially like when I'm in the States, because they have a lot of like taco places. So you'll see like Del Taco and Taco Time, Taco Bell, and all these sort of things. And you'll see TV ads, and it's like, Mega Beef Taco! Yeah. It's like, doo-doo-doo! It's just like 49 cents. And you're like, boom, and it's like 49 cents. Dude, there's a point where the price is unattractive. There's no fucking
cheap
way in the world I'm eating a 49 cent taco. There's no way. It weighs a third of a pound. There's a third of a pound of material. They're 49 cents. From the shipping, the manufacturing, every single cost put together, you're still making profit on 49 cents.
Like the heat in the building you're buying it in, the cleaning and upkeep of the building.
Yeah.
The,
at that point,
the,
it's like they got paid
the rent
to sell it.
To like, yeah. Well, it might be a pulling, and it's like, you know, you buy a fountain drink and they make 100% profit.
Yeah, exactly. You go there, you buy a 49 cent thing, but then it's the type of people that go there that also buy the mega large Coke and the fucking another order of 10 tacos and other shit, you know?
I guess maybe they do lose money on the 49 cent taco. They're trying to bring you in to buy their fountain pop or something. I don't know. But some of the prices there are just too scary.
Yeah, it makes you wonder, that's for sure, man.
But I also miss being able to eat that stuff. Because in university, I could eat any motherfucking thing. I could eat anything, I'd feel great.
I eat the ass, I eat any motherfucking thing.
I eat the pussy, I eat the butt, I eat every motherfucking thing. But I don't. I'm not into the butt.
I don't eat the butt.
Do you eat the butt, Joel? Because I've never tried, so I suppose I'm not allowed to knock it or something, but I'm just taking a guess. My hypothesis.
Joel, a finger press shit.
Yeah. Yeah. No, do the butt eating. On that note, I have to take a pee. I'm going to go rub one out.
Talked about eating butt. Jarett's got to go to the bathroom.
I'll be back.
Oh, I just gonna get all my earwax on this motherfucker right here, put it back in Jarett's ear, and he will be not happy about that. So, Joel, are you gonna be streaming some shit? I heard you guys were rocking the setup today and getting everything.
Yeah, it's looking pretty good, man. Everything is looking pretty solid today. So
nice.
It's just a matter of kind of setting aside a block of time where I can do it and just do it, you know. And I also want to let people know a couple days ahead of time.
Mm-hmm. That's good. Yeah, we will tweet that out and Facebook that out.
We're going to be doing it on this stream, people are asking. So we'll be streaming it on this channel when it does happen.
I think Joel's streaming from his Xbox, right?
I'll be streaming some Xbox shit, yeah. I could also stream some PC stuff. Maybe some Battlefield 4. But I haven't really got much on my PC these days. I've been playing a little Diablo 3, playing a little of that again.
Yeah, Joel said PC because I think he was going to say a word in the future that was probably like PC shit. So it turned into PC. I write ahead when I'm handwriting and when I'm typing, like
she probably did shit.
Yeah, like I always mess up the word because I'm thinking three words ahead. I'm like, I'm trying to catch up in my writing.
Path of Exile, actually, yeah, I just downloaded that. I'm excited to try that out, man. It's like another, I'd say like D3 clone, but it's not. Mm-hmm. It's like the real successor to Diablo 2, it seems, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know if you know anything about it, but it's a pretty sick dungeon crawler or loot gatherer, kind of top-down D3 style game.
I think we started playing that for a stream, and it was like me and Jarett, we started like on a beach, whatever, and you're marooned, and that was as far as I got. Like we just tested the game, but I haven't played it at all.
Yeah, it's got some pretty cool elements to it. Like there's no golden in it or anything in the economy. It's all just loot based.
Getting items and trading items and
Yeah, and barter system and that kind of shit.
Interesting. Because I think that, you know, generally the barter system doesn't really work so well in real life, but like, hey, maybe in the game it's the way to go. Like, there's enough players that can be in touch with each other. There's no reason for gold. There's no reason for the middleman.
Yeah, yeah. The economy is flawless, this guy's saying.
Oh, nice. Someone says the Keanu Reeves skit you guys did blew my mind. Yeah.
Surprised it's got such little views, dude.
Yeah, I thought more people would be into checking out our very, very early, crazy, fun with video cameras, I guess you'd call it. I don't know what else.
Yeah.
But yeah, Joel, I'm still a big fan of the 80s song you did, the rap song. Like, remember you got some beat on some drum machine at Derek's place, whatever. And like, it's like the cheesiest, most hilarious beat still to this day. Like,
yeah, it was like they picked the most 80s sounding beat possible.
Yeah,
that's what we went with.
Don't do drugs was the name of the video. Check it out on YouTube/KylePP or Joel's channel as well. Has it? I'm not sure what Joel's channel is. Jarett's really rubbing one out. I looked. I got a text from him just now. He said he's rubbing one out.
You got a text from him? He's like on the fucking toilet?
Yeah, he's like, Geoff, I'm gonna be like rubbing one out, so like please like talk to the people for like for like 4.5 minutes. Got some good material in here. There's a magazine. He's looking at his phone.
That's funny.
He's on Red Tube on his phone. And yeah, he's rubbing one out, man. It's weird knowing that. It's just weird knowing weird that. It's like, imagine you live with a guy, he's your roommate. He's like, I'm just going to rub one out. So if you hear anything, it's not me getting choked by a prowler. I'm into that, whatever, asphyxiation. I think I just heard Jarett like yell something. I think we're watching something on TV. Oh, here he is. He's done early. Sorry. It was
you must have been thinking about me and shit.
What? This is the one you had in your earlier. Sorry. I was watching the Toronto Raptors are playing.
Oh, that's when you climaxed?
I climaxed in the Raptors game just now. No, it was weird. I was just getting a drink, and I saw there was 9 seconds left in the fourth quarter, and they were tied 87-87. And then this play happened, and then the refs couldn't make a decision on which way the ball should go.
Oh, my God.
It was like the clock ended, and they couldn't tell if it hit the rim or not, so they actually decided to like not make a call in either direction and just throw the ball up in the center and see what. 9 seconds left. And then Houston grabs it and has a chance to win and then fails because they suck. And so now they're going to overtime. But whatever. I didn't care about fucking basketball. I just care about weird moments in life where, like, this is intense for a lot of people right
this
now.
This is live now.
Yeah, it's live right now. A bunch of people are freaking out about this. I thought that'd be pretty nice. Joel, have you tried Path of Exile? Yeah? Path of Exile.
We just talked about Path of Exile, man. Shit.
Oh, did you? Dude, have you played it? I missed it. Because
I downloaded it.
That's a good start, I guess.
Yes.
You got to do that before you can play it.
No, I know a bit about it. I've heard quite a bit about it, and it definitely sounds awesome and interesting. So,
dude, I have I played it a little bit. It's obviously like, you know, it's very Diablo inspired, but it doesn't seem to really hold your hand. It seems very complex. And take a look at the skill tree. It's actually it's totally ridiculous. Like when I first looked at it, it actually made me want to quit the game right away. And then the hardcore gamer in me is like, dude, just chill. They just, you know, they're at some point in your understanding of this game, you'll appreciate that probably. But
so you're playing it then?
As a brand new, I'm not really playing it. I have it installed. I've played it a couple of times. I've literally invested less than 2 hours into the game. So I'm still at the point, when I look at that skill tree, it's incredibly intimidating. It's just,
yeah,
it looks like something I'm like, oh, fuck, dude. Like, I don't have, this can't be my full-time job. I can't be thinking, I can't spend hours and hours just to figure out the skill tree. But then when I started leveling my dude, there was never really more than a couple choices at a time. So it's a pretty linear progression. Just that when you look at it all, it looks really fucking cool, right?
Well, still though, dude, I heard there's some scary facts that there's no like full respect. You can only go back a certain amount of points. So you might find that in the future, a path you took would totally fucked you up, and you went
the wrong way. Whatever,
and you back up enough. You just have to re-roll.
Yeah, you re-roll. You
need to like level 30 and having the re-roll.
So long as they don't make you delete your character, so long as you have slots to re-roll with, that's everything Diablo pre-3, right?
Yeah.
I think it was, when I played, it was pretty hardcore, man. I had multiple Amazons. I had multiple because I wanted to try different build paths. Leveling's part of the fun. I don't know. In a game like that, like.
Well, it's so funny that, like, you know, for so many years, we had those kind of hardcore games like Ultima and that kind of shit, and then they went away. And for so many years, I wanted those games. And now we're getting a few of them back, like Path of Exile. But I just don't have the time now to, like, invest in them. It's just, like, now too hardcore, and
yeah.
I just don't have the time anymore.
Yeah, it's too bad. It's too bad. Well, in another 15 years, Monkey Man will be off to university, kick him out of the house somewhere. then, maybe, hopefully, at that point, like, we're up. Think about retirement and be planning.
I'll be inside the video game, man.
Yeah, which MMO do I retire to? Because when I think about retirement, like, I don't really think about moving to Florida and sitting on a beach and watching water lap. I think about where our MMO is going to be at 20, 30, 40 years from now. Considering how far
games in general.
Like, well, just today, and, oh, I wish I had the tab open. I'm going to try to fucking find it. But just today, I was watching a guy at some kind of trade show in Japan with an Oculus Rift having sex. Did you see that shit?
No, I didn't see the sex.
You don't even know this part then, man.
Oh, no.
There's a device pressed against his crotch area. Now, he's in a public trade show, so the fleshlight isn't hooked up, but it's one simple attachment. You add the fleshlight. You put a fleshlight in this thing, and he's pushing against it, and you can see what he sees. He's got the Oculus Rift on. He's just doing this, and then you can see what he sees, which he's just like, just pound this girl, and it's like, it's literally the virtual sex simulator. So, I mean, like, fuck every other game, man, because at the end of the day, you're a fucking animal.
Dude, what's going to happen when...
The sex simulator...
Simulated sex is so good that you don't necessarily need a partner anymore.
No, GG, girls. GG. I'm not opening the door for you. Are you crazy? I'm going to use my sex simulator, man. I'm not buying you dinner. I got a fucking sex simulator, man. I fucking need a wedding ring. Are you from... I got a sex simulator. Like, fuck.
I have a sex spot. What the fuck?
Yeah, no, it's amazing. And then when you think about things like Ellen Page, for instance, who in my opinion is like, you know, one of, if not the cutest girls in Hollywood now, making stuff, right? Really beautiful young lady. So she did some kind of shower thing whenever a bunch of guys like extrapolated her exact 3D physical form. So now she exists, ultra high res 3D modeled, one of the most beautiful girls that people fantasize about in the world, sits there fully 3D modeled. The tech, the model exists, it's right there. And then you combine it with this crazy technology I was just watching today from Japan. And what you have is a reality that's just a few years off, where you can essentially have nearly realistic, crazy virtual sex with any person that you desire, any famous person, and any 10, 20 years from now, it will be anybody. And it's pretty intense to think about. But even beyond that, just the Oculus Rift in general, that technology is so amazing. And when you apply that to an MMO, not like World of Warcraft grind leveling fucking that kind of stuff, but I'm talking about a true open world, an Ultima Online world, a GTA world, but that's not about one specific criminal thing. Just like Ultima Online 2030 with Oculus Rift. You know, that's retirement, man. You know, that's how everyone's got a castle. Everyone's got oceanfront property. Everyone's got, you know, 70 virgins, and it's not even the afterlife, man. It's just retirement in the year 2046, right?
Well, yeah, when your body starts shutting down and your body and, like, the virtual world
Did you see that sex simulator today?
No, today.
Maybe I should try to find that. I should.
It's right here. Some guy linked it.
Oh, yeah?
Instinct linked it in chat.
Live leak? Or is it the...
The Kotaku.
So he doesn't actually have a sticker.
If he wasn't, I'd probably play some
chicks. He's like, man, I wish I could whip my dick out right now.
Yeah.
Because that chick's pretty hot.
And keep in mind, this is so rudimentary. This is the beginning. Like, this is caveman virtual sex.
Well,
like, he's pushing it. Metallic thing. I'm just think 20 years in the future, right?
Well, I'm really surprised there isn't a product where right now a cam girl can touch like this phallus shaped thing with sensors on it, and it translates to a thing that you put on your home that you buy for $300 on your dick, and the sensations translate like through whatever. And it's like, I'm really surprised. It's because hand jobs over the internet and like banging chicks over the internet and fellatio over the internet is like, man, you want to make a billion, like $100 billion, you make that.
That's when the top 10 richest people in the world are all women, and men stand no chance. Doesn't matter the corporation you build, because you're not just blowing a dick through the internet.
You're blowing 10,000 dicks
at the same fucking time.
At the same time,
every thrust,
and each of them are paying $99, and then it's like, it's like 10 minutes. You made 99 cents, but 10 minutes you made $10,000. Like,
I was thinking about all the jizz, but you generated pounds and pounds of jizz. No, that's too far. Too far. Anyway, it's still amazing. It's
the philosophical concept of how much jizz you generate.
Yes, it is pretty scary.
If that was an evolutionary like measure, you would be the queen. But there will be a porn star that makes a 100,000 guys jizz a day.
Yeah.
And makes, come on, at least 99 cents is what they'll charge for that. At least.
Dude, you know, you said $90. I'm like, no, $90 is probably what it costs now. If I had to take a random guess, never picked up a streetwalker, but if I throw a guess at $100, right?
You know how much?
No.
What?
It's going to be 99 cents is what I'm getting, because she's servicing 10,000 guys simultaneously.
Well, dude. Apps,
it's got to be
like that.
You know
like,
how much it costs
like,
to like just go into like a private chat room with like a cam girl or something.
Am I pulling that shit out of your ear?
Dude, this shit's so tight. I can't.
But am I pulling it out of your ear?
I'm not, right? You know what? If you fucking sat here, you'd have pulled it out of my ear fucking 6 months time.
If I was like talking with my hands.
I talk with my hand. I'm a fucking hand.
But like it's the app store mentality of like 99 cents is negligible. I'm going to compete with piracy, right? So it's like, whatever, I watch some porn for free or get a virtual blowjob over the internet. You know, it's like, so yeah, that's, I think that's the future. I think I'm surprised it doesn't exist. Like you could even, there's even a market for that if you had to sell the thing for $3,000 and then you just make a couple of girls blow guys over the
internet. Dude, $3,000, people are, these fucking dudes, more videos you guys can YouTube after this, but there's dudes that they pay like $5,000-$6,000 for real dolls.
Yeah.
For a doll, and we won't get into the conversation about how creepy some of these guys are and assign personalities to these dolls and consider them beings. But anyway, there exist guys that spend thousands and thousands of dollars on dolls, and this is so beyond a doll in terms of its interactive potential. Right? Mm-hmm. The fleshlight mounted onto a motor mounted into an Oculus Rift and et cetera. So come on, man. and that all integrates into MMOs. So MMOs and...
Dude, you're going to be fucking people in MMOs.
Dude, yeah. You're going to meet the girl of your dreams, the 450-pound back hairy guy that stinks on the other end of the line, but whatever. He's a beautiful girl in the game, and what? You don't fucking see him.
Hey, man. There are always people that are playing like attractive characters. And
yeah.
It'll be the philosophical question. What matters? What they are in flesh, this useless amount of real flesh, or what they want to be and purport to be and project to be. You
dude,
know, it's like,
dude, now this is your movie, man. This is Eyes Wide What?
Eyes Wide What? It's like, yeah, my wife, never met her in real life, don't want to.
Don't want to.
Probably a dude.
Exactly.
But we bang every day over the internet.
You know, but you wake up tomorrow and be like, man, cheers. That's right. This is my Kubrick moment. Eyes Wide What, man?
Eyes Wide What?
And it's a porn, and it has philosophical implications and brings up questions about technology and society.
It does.
And romance and relationships.
It's got everything, man.
It's got everything. Everything's there.
Eyes Wide What?
And then at the end, he meets a girl, and she actually is totally beautiful, and he realizes it didn't matter at all.
That's the Hollywood ending.
Oh, that's what everyone wants to hear.
The Kubrick ending is she's frozen and like this. like he finds out she's been dead and he's been banging a dead frozen girl.
Yeah, he was worried it was a fat guy. Turns out, no, it was a dead something.
The movie Surrogates, somebody's asking. Yeah, the movie Surrogates is like that. I don't know if you've ever seen Surrogates.
Oh, yeah, it's the documentary on real dolls? Or?
No, it's a Bruce Willis movie.
Oh, no way.
Yeah, it's pretty crazy.
Wasn't Kubrick.
It's not bad. It's crazy though, like places like China, like these dolls are a necessity because, you know, most of their population is fucking male, dude. Because of their birth policies and shit, dude.
Still hand I'm lotion saying. Effective.
It's like effective. What?
But no, it's scary. I just saw some mini documentary. It wasn't a full documentary, or maybe it was a clip of a full one. I don't know. It was like 10 minutes. I watched it, but it was about the maybe it was a Vice special thing about modern Japanese.
I saw
culture.
That. Yeah, how no one's dating. There's just too much hassle.
There's too much
drama.
Hassle in 20 something culture. Yeah. So there's like cuddle clinics and
oh,
so
yeah.
When you want to
when you want
to cuddle a girl, you go pay a girl to cuddle you, and you want some sex, you'll pay a girl then to blow you, and something like this.
It's just commodities.
And they've commoditized every single aspect of human relationships.
Well, even the women that go to talk to men that serve them drinks and they hang out and they have a conversation.
Yeah. You're paying
it's like
that to me is like Japan's like as far as any culture's ever gone in terms
that's
of
that's gonna yank now.
In terms of building, you know, a consumer culture, I don't think, you know, even the U.S. isn't anywhere near where Japan seems to be right now in terms of its culture of just commoditizing everything, consuming everything, pricing on everything.
And it being so okay.
Well, it's so okay internally in their culture, but it's not okay in the grand scheme of things. When you look at them, they're dying. Like, their population is decreasing. And at the rate that they're headed and where they're coming from, there's not going to be a Japan in like 100 years because people aren't reproducing. Like it's not a healthy way for a country or a culture to persist is to have all of its people not want to, you know, reproduce anymore.
Yeah.
You know, if you're the leader of a country or a culture and one of your objectives is to, you know,
have it persist.
To have, you know, not go extinct. It's kind of important that your people fuck. For the purpose of having babies and stuff.
Real Jeremy and Doug dolls, PP merch, someone says.
Dude, I would totally sell a Jeremy doll. I'd love it. I have to admit that. No, dude, I would cast my penis and everything. Like, if I sold it to, like, one girl, it'd be like somewhere out there, there's a girl, and she's having sex with a doll of me. And that made me feel pretty fucking good, man. Right? Wouldn't that would be amazing, man.
There's a movie. A girl is obsessed with the real doll of a guy, and the guy that cast the doll shows up and impersonates the doll.
Ooh.
And stays still one night.
Ooh.
And there's the movie.
And then he gets hard. She's like, what the fuck?
I think they're always hard, aren't they?
Then he gets off and goes soft. He's like, this is bullshit.
Bullshit.
My doll's broken. This is garbage. Throw this piece of shit back.
Well, man, there's guys that I saw a trailer for the Real Doll documentary or some. I can't remember what video I saw. People are leaving. Look at that. Numbers are going down.
Oh, my God.
I don't want to hear.
Nine people just left.
I will stop my story.
You actually did.
No, Joe's got to go. Well, we should probably game.
It's 11.
Oh, shit, it's too late.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, I was going to say those guys that, like, repair and clean real dolls.
Doug, are you mad?
No, I was looking at my phone, dude. And, good text.
Sorry, Joel relaxed his face. He's mad. Seriously, he looks...
the reactions I get of, like, Joel, look at Joel looks mad. Joel looks sad. It's just like, this is my normal face, man.
Joel looks mad because I'm not letting him talk. Were we not letting you talk? Was I talking about
that? I don't know. Shit, I was looking at my phone.
Joel relaxed his face.
How's your phone doing, man? Speaking of phones, mm-hmm. I am very excited. The moment I've been waiting for, see my previous Google device was toddlered and died a while ago, and then a very generous friend lent me his phone, which is what I've been using right here, the Galaxy Note. But the Nexus 5 came out. That's what I've been waiting for. Ordered my Nexus 5. Mm-hmm. Didn't make that first 27-minute fucking window because I wasn't camping it like a fiend. And so it's not going to get to me for like another 2 weeks or whatever. But pretty exciting. Awesome. I'm excited to rejoin the world of like cutting-edge technology. So for that 1 or 2 weeks where you feel like, yeah, this is special until you're like used to it.
Anything else is garbage.
Phones stopped exciting me now, though, man. Like, I'm not really excited about phones anymore.
Yeah, it's not going to change your life, right? You're not going to do anything different. It's just going to be a bit faster, a bit this.
And I wouldn't be getting a Nexus 5 if I still had my Nexus 3, right? Or my Galaxy Nexus is what it's called. But I mean, it's like, it's just that I miss like the pure Google experience. I miss the speed of my phone. And it's like, gotta have something. I'm hoping that I don't smash this one or it doesn't break and I can keep it for like a long fucking time because I don't know what else phones need, really. It's like, there's some technology that will be used
your wrist now and
new watch soon. Yeah,
there's the watches, I guess. But unless that replaces, but I think most of those watches are...
There's no way I would get one of those fucking watches. Having that cancer stick around your wrist, like, at all times?
Well, man, you know, the
I keep this near my butt and balls, man. What the fuck? I prefer it on my wrist?
At all times? I seriously keep my phone, like, off my body, like, at all times.
If I'm out and about, it's in my pocket. Right?
No, yeah, I won't. It'll always be, like, just, like, in my hand or, like, on a table or something.
Well, I don't want hand cancer, man. I don't want table cancer either.
I'd rather have pan cancer than ball cancer, dude. Shit.
I put it near my butt. I guess it's still near
my butt. I don't know. You lose a nut or lose your hand. Like.
I don't think hand cancer is a thing. I'm no biologist, but...
speaking theoretically here.
but you know what? I think if phones do go to our wrists, I think we run the risk of like pretty crackhead, like habitual, checking of like
there is like, now,
like,
though.
Like, now you have to like reach into your pocket, pull it out, and like put it back in your pocket. If it's on your wrist and you're just like, yeah, you're having a conversation, you're like, yeah, uh huh, yeah, uh huh. It like, do you think it will be like a shorter path to like just constantly checking the internet and your phone and your text and whatever? Like, we're already there to some degree, but it's not this close. Like, you don't always have it in your hand. You're not always flipping it in your face, you know?
Well, what's going to be like Google Glasses, dude?
Oh, that's going to be stupid. It's going to be like, uh-huh, sorry, can you repeat that? like, you're not even going to know when the people are checking their shit. Like,
expressions. Staring back at you. You'll never have any idea if someone's listening to you. Dude, it's terrible. I'm not excited. Man, there was a time in my youth where I used to think where like all new technological advancements excited me. And it was all like necessarily good. There was like a goodness to advancing technology.
Yeah, that's going
to
be a better
experience. It's an idealist thing in me, but yeah, it's going to increase the average level of happiness, but you know, maybe it's that I'm just fucking old. I don't know. But like there's nothing beneficial about that to me at all. Like I think it's going to be a massive regression for like our society in general to have everyone constantly distracted, like 100% of the time beamed into your fucking eyeball distraction from everything going on around you. I don't want to live in a world where I'm walking by people in the street and everyone's got cameras on me. And as I walk by, I know I've been permanently recorded for all human history, person after person after person after person. I know that the AI is auto-tagging my face. So on their Facebook account, their social media account somewhere, they know they just walked by Jarett Cale, and there it is. It's like, oh, auto fucking tagged. And then everything that I do, everywhere I've gone in public, is being recorded for all human history, all of my my steps.
It's dude, like, have you like experienced any of that facial recognition shit on Facebook?
No, I know that it exists in its infancy.
I just posted a couple pictures the other day, and as I put my mouse over the picture, it's like, oh, do you want to tag this person? And I'm like, whoa, what? That blur in the background? How the fuck did you know that was that dude?
Mm-hmm. It's amazing.
It was scary, scary fucking accurate, man.
Triangulated his facial structure. Yeah, no. And again, this technology is in its infancy, man. I mean, computers have been around 20 years. Like, what do you think it's going to be 200 years from now? Anyway, it's really all the sci-fi used to be about getting chips implanted in your neck and all this, and maybe we'll still go to implants. I know that Samsung just patented a tattoo, so you could tattoo something in your neck that would act as a microphone, so you could talk to you whatever. So we'll probably still go there, but what's really funny is that it's like it doesn't have to be that intrusive to the point where they put it into your body to keep it there. It's like everyone's consciously made a choice to carry around their device on them 24/7, like. Everybody I know, when we go out, anywhere we go, they have their fucking device. It's got GPS. It's got everything on. It's got a microphone. It's like, it's listening. It's tracking. It's doing everything. Every single thing they search or talk to is like recorded for all time and is essentially publicly available, because even though it's not in this era, it will be in the future archaeologically. And it is right now to your government. I mean, it's like, it's the creepiest, most Orwellian thing. And everyone's just blindly, sheepishly.
You ever seen Transcendent Man?
No, man.
Great Ray Kurzweil. Do you know who Ray Kurzweil
is?
Great fucking documentary, man.
Well, you know, I think there'll be some backlash, because there are some technologies that haven't, like, you know how when you own a dog, you can put a chip, and most owners do, they put a chip under their skin that identifies them when they're lost. So even if they don't have no collar, they can be identified.
Oh, yeah.
You could put a chip under your skin and pay for shit with your finger.
Oh, yeah.
But it's just, I think people draw a line. It's a creepy factor. Like,
dude, if you explained this technology to people 50 years ago, it was line crossing.
Yeah, maybe.
It's totally line crossing. Line is a matter of culture, dude. And it's been proven time and again that
culture's going to change. And like, you know,
culture can be changed in a matter of a few Coach Brothers commercials, man. Come on.
Yeah, I'm going to be afraid someone's chopping off my finger to take the chip that I swiped.
Your grandchildren are going to laugh at you that you didn't chip the day it came out. And they're chipped up. They're updating their chips every second year, man.
Hey, yo, guys, I got to get going.
All right. You know, we got it, too.
Yeah, we're going to sign off.
I can't believe it's been over 3 hours already. Or about 3 hours. We had some technical hurdles at the start. About 3 hours. That's what we had gunned for. It's getting pretty late.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, Europe's long asleep. The Aussies are probably just waking up.
Yeah, and they're like, oh, shit.
Europe's just starting to go back up now. It's funny.
Yeah, good day. Good day, Aussies.
All right, I'll see you guys later. Love everybody in the stream. Thanks for watching. I'll be streaming some games soon.
Yeah. So. Totally. He is
awesome.
Hold him to that. Later.
There goes Joel.
And we's backs.
There we go. Yeah, man. We got to stream again sometime. I don't know when.
Oh. Play Poe.
Why are we still listening to Joel?
That's ridiculous, actually.
There we go.
Talk ESO next stream.
ESO. I totally know what that is.
Yeah. I'm quickly running through my brain.
My TLAs.
Oh.
Stream tomorrow. We're writing tomorrow, in fact.
Yeah, can stream tomorrow. Oh, Elder Scrolls Online. Oh, okay, yeah. I will. I started to touch on it, and then I think I got overridden or interrupted by whatever, and then I never went back to it. But it's when we were on the PS4 discussion in terms of some of the games coming out soon that I was excited for, that was kind of one of them. Back when I used to play MMOs a lot, I always used to dream of them being on consoles, because it's a game you put so many hours into that sitting at a computer desk felt painful. And I used to dream of just being able to sit back on a couch, fucking relax in my main living room where it's more open and maybe there's people coming going, and then have voice chat. So I don't have to type. I hate typing to people. I'd rather have my hands do the controlling of my character, and then my voice can talk. So these modern MMOs now are all being made for consoles. Sit back, voice talk, play with your hands, relax on your couch, feet in the air, dick out, and just loving life, man.
Mm-hmm.
And Elder Scrolls is, you know, it's a pretty awesome universe. I didn't get all that into Skyrim, but
people say Elder Scrolls is a superior IP.
Dude, if Skyrim was an MMO, I'd have been all over that ass. The main reason I couldn't get into it is that it's all for nothing. It's all single player sandbox stuff, and you're building up a sandbox in your own little house, but it doesn't really, like, you don't get to really show it off. It doesn't seem like it's worth anything at the end of the day. But when you play an MMO, it's like every little bit of character progression, you feel like I can apply this in the future to being awesome around other people.
Mm-hmm.
Whether it's kicking their ass in a duel or doing something or grouping with them or whatever. But it's the way your skills apply to other people's experiences that make you want to raise them. But yeah, when you're just at home by yourself in a tiny sandbox single player, it's very hard for me to put more than, I think I put 8 hours in Skyrim. That's pretty pathetic, but that's it.
Honestly, man, Skyrim versus Fallout 3, I'd go so Fallout 3. Like, I think it's twice as good of an experience from a design perspective.
I gotta play Fallout 3, man. 90% of my 5-year door, remember one hero? Same thing. Pudge. Oh, fuck Pudge, man. Pudge. Pudge is why I don't play Dota 2, man.
Yandere's Revenge. What's best Soviet counter to fuckloads of prism
tanks? Dude, I forgot about prism tanks.
Yeah.
I loved prism tanks. Oh.
I don't even remember, but prism tanks didn't shoot air, so any air, right? They were all ground only.
I don't know. I don't know. I never played Yuri's Revenge like competitively or anything. I can't.
So I played Fallout New Vegas, and it was the other people that made it, the other studio. So I can't remember which, but Bethesda does two different studios, whatever. New Vegas was good. I played it, but it wasn't the same polished game experience in terms of having very interesting encounters with a subplot or a substory or a character. And it wasn't the same experience in terms of the right amount of stuff being encountered at the right amount of time and the right, you know, the flow of the game for Fallout 3 was far superior, because, you know, when you're playing one of those games like Skyrim, for example, is a great example of, like, damn, my quest log has become a chore list, and I've lost interest in my quests because there's so many quests to do, and I just, it's a chore list now, and I feel like not playing this game. I'm like, fuck, there's too much shit. Who's this guy? I forgot about it, you know. So Fallout 3 had a great flow in terms of the amount of material that was presented to you based on the amount you adventured. And then you would get to a place where it was too hard for you to venture because you have to get to a higher level. And then you would so you wouldn't be bombarded with too many quests in that area. And you'd have to go and then earn the XP and weapons and skill to go and venture that area, which you wanted to go see. So whereas Skyrim is like, you can go wherever the fuck you want right off the bat at level 0, which is a fatal design flaw in my opinion. Well, they made money, they made, you know, whatever, but honestly, that's why Fallout 3 will always be more awesome than Skyrim for me.
Compelling, man. It's a compelling argument.
Honestly, when you play Fallout 3 and you see all the sub stories and all the some stories suck you in, you can't leave the stories, and it's like you fuck your quest log. You got to deal with this shit now, and you're in a different like environment, and it's like it's really like okay, this is great because I'm glad I can do this, and then you know there's one-off characters with unique weapons that are really cool that are. You know, you hunt, you seek out these unique weapons that are like this weapon, except more powerful and special. And anyway, it was really good that way.
It's on my list. This is it. Well, should we say goodbye?
Mm-hmm.
No, we should say goodbye. It's getting really late.
Yeah.
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 Love watching ourselves on a delay. Drop my rings everywhere, man.
All right, everybody, we're out of here. It's been a good stream. We will do it again soon, possibly on the weekend. I'm not sure. We'll have to see what the deal is.
But... yes, very soon. Very soon. You know, tonight is the end of season 3 of League of Legends.
So we're going to have to see what's going on and see if there's something we're streaming about.
And
emergency soon. Stream.
You know, I got really excited last week, right before the lesson, on the public test realm of League of Legends, they accidentally released queues for 1v1 and 2v2. And I know that they've been working on it for months and months and months. When I thought it's coming in season 4, at the start of season 4, which is like a week or two away or something. Mm-hmm. So it made sense. The timing made sense. But it ended up being an accident that they released these queues. But I thought that last week they were going to have the 1v1 queue up. And I'm mm-hmm. super excited. I was like, Geoff, I literally said to Geoff, I'm like, Geoff, I'm taking the whole day off. Like, morning, I'm just streaming the entire fucking day. 1v1 and kicking people's ass with Caitlyn. That's all I wanted to do. All fucking day, raid people with Caitlyn. And it never hit. So whenever that hits, the promise holds, man. Whenever a league puts in 1v1, man, some bitch is going to get owned.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Man.
Someone wants us to sign off in character. Is that a possibility?
Yeah, no.
Not going to happen. Gonna wait for the movie, man, or our in-character stream, which might happen at some point, but we'll see. Totally could happen.
I'm totally gonna go, so this like been super gay, and you guys are super gay, and then you guys are super gay out, and like super gay with you like some other time or something. So good? Super gay? Alright. Yeah, there it is.